Welcome to part 2 of my Marvel Spider-Man Retrospective series. If you haven't seen part 1, it covers the main story of the game, and although I'd highly recommend watching it before this one, it's not necessary if you'd like to just jump in here. In this video, though, we'll explore all the extra content outside of the main story, such as DLC, side missions, unlockable suits, the open world, and plenty, plenty more, and I'll include relevant behind-the-scenes details, Easter eggs, and references along with them. I also want to note that this will be a full-on spoiler video for everything Marvel Spider-Man 1, including the prequel novel, but not so much for the Miles Morales and Spider-Man 2 games, although I will reference them occasionally. But anyway, we have a lot to talk about and I don't want to waste any more time, so let's get started. I think the best place to begin is where the story picks back up, which is during the City That Never Sleeps DLC series. The first DLC story pack is called The Heist, and it reintroduces us to Black Cat. Actually, on second thought, maybe it's better to first take a step back and look at the Black Cat side mission in the main game. While you're swinging around the city, you'll get a voicemail from an unknown number. It's the Black Cat telling Spider-Man to come to an address and see if he can catch her. When he arrives, he finds another recorded message.
Hello, Spider. Been thinking about you a lot lately. We were good together, weren't we? Maybe it's time to reignite the flame.
Like she alludes to, Spider-Man and Black Cat had a relationship a while back in the game's continuity. This is similar to the comics, where Spider-Man and Black Cat also had a brief relationship. Things actually got serious in the comics, to the point that Peter even revealed his identity to her. He also knows her secret identity, which is Felicia Hardy. The problem was, though, that Felicia was more in love with Spider-Man than she was with Peter Parker. In that same comic issue, we even see Black Cat horrified after Peter reveals his identity to her, telling him to put the mask back on. No wonder Peter doesn't ever reveal his identity. Still, they remained together since this was a first for Peter Parker. Up until now, it was his Spider-Man identity that got in the way of his relationships, and a secret that he had to keep from potential partners. With Felicia, it's the opposite, since she encourages him to embrace his Spider-Man life, which was exciting for him. On her end, she's excited to finally have a partner who can keep up with her. However, she doesn't really understand Peter's need for a normal civilian life. For her, she's pretty much Black Cat all the time, and Felicia Hardy isn't really a thing. So she often pushes them to ditch the Peter Parker life and go full-time Spider-Man with her. Her life of crime is also very lucrative, and she enjoys her current lifestyle, so she's put off when she sees Peter's normal life. For example, she's extremely disappointed when she sees Peter's apartment, expecting an extraordinary superhero to be living an extravagant lifestyle. Later in the issue, when Peter offers for them to go back to his place, she declines and tells him that they'll go to hers instead. Peter, on the other hand, is disappointed in her life of crime and regularly pushes her to go straight and be a hero. She actually attempts this, but finds that money becomes more of a problem. So I'm sure you have a good idea of why their relationship ultimately didn't work out. It's a constant push and pull between them, wanting the other to change aspects of their lives to suit the others. So as you'd expect, they eventually broke up. In the game, Peter and Black Cat have already dated and broken up, and this is her mysterious return. Up until now, Peter thought she had given up her thrill-seeking life of crime, but it seems she's back at it again, leaving little cat dolls at the locations of areas she's recently robbed. The extent of this side mission is finding each of these locations in hopes of tracking down Black Cat to discover her plans. Peter also calls Yuri to give her a heads up on what's going on. She states that they still have all of Black Cat's equipment in police lockup and that she'll send someone to retrieve the cat dolls that we find. As we continue tracking them down, some of the locations include fun comic references as well.
That's Ty Stone's place, and it's full of priceless art. You're playing with fire, Felicia, but I guess that's how you roll.
Ty Stone, short for Tiberius Stone, is a character from the comics. He started off as a childhood friend and rival of Tony Stark. They competed at everything, and Ty was obsessed with beating Tony. After Stark inherited his parents' fortune after their death, Tiberius even had his own parents murdered to keep up with Tony. Tiberius Stone is also known as a founder of the company Alchemax, along with Liz Allen. Alchemax is best known as the powerhouse business of 2099, and is also responsible for giving Miguel O'Hara the spider powers that make him Spider-Man 2099. It's also Tiberius's son, Tyler Stone, who runs Alchemax in that future. During the 2099 comics, Miguel also learns that Tyler Stone is his father, so Tiberius Stone is Miguel O'Hara's grandfather. Another location Black Cat steals from is Cornelius Van Lunt's place. Cornelius Van Lunt is of course rich, but he's also secretly the villain Taurus. As Taurus, he's part of the criminal team known as Zodiac, with each member taking on the moniker of the various Zodiac signs. At another location, Peter recognizes it as the home of Lonesome Pinky.
I think Lonesome Pinky lives here. Stealing from a country singer, she's getting creative.
Lonesome Pinky is from the comics and was Peter's neighbor for a while. For multiple comic issues, we never actually saw him. We could only see Peter's reaction to his singing at all hours of the night. Peter hated his voice and couldn't get any rest at his apartment due to Pinky's constant singing. One day, Peter got so frustrated that he punched a hole in their shared wall, allowing them to see each other for the first time. Pinky was actually pretty cool about it and introduces himself as Lonesome Pincus, an aspiring country singer. In the game, it looks like he's been more successful and thankfully isn't living next to Peter. Lastly, there's another location that Peter claims holds the Jade Tiger statue, which is worth $1 million. I think this could also be a reference to the Jade Tiger statue in the comics, and pieces of it are used as enchanted amulets giving the wearer powerful abilities. These amulets are most commonly associated with the hero White Tiger and the Sons of the Tiger from the Deadly Hands of Kung Fu series. But after finding all the locations that Black Cat stole from, Peter creates an algorithm to help him determine where to find her. Believing to have the coordinates to her hideout, we head there next. Peter was right, Black Cat was indeed using this area as a hideout, but she's already gone. Still, we can find some interesting details around the room. The first is that she has records of financial data on the Magia crime families, and Peter speculates that she's planning on blackmailing them. We also find a portrait of Vanessa Fisk, Wilson Fisk's wife, and he apparently reported this stolen a few years back, so Black Cat is pretty ballsy when it comes to her targets. Lastly, we find a workbench with a new spider suit on it. Black Cat left a message stating that she wanted to make him something a little more flattering. This unlocks the dark suit, which we can now use as an alternate outfit. This is also a nod to a couple different moments in the comics. The first is that this is a legit suit from the comics, originating during a Deadpool team-up, although it wasn't made by Black Cat. She has, however, made Peter a black suit before. We all know about Peter's time wearing the symbiote suit, but after he ditched it, Black Cat made him a cloth version so he could maintain the look without the risk of an alien bonding to him. Black Cat also said that she thinks the black suit is a lot sexier than his red and blue suit, which is the main reason she made it. So it's fitting that she would make him another black suit in the game. The red and black color scheme could also be a nod to the original concept for the symbiote suit back in 1983. The way the story goes, Marvel ran a competition back in the day for new ideas. The winner was a fan named Randy Schuler, who suggested the idea of a black suit, and the original concept featured a black suit with a red logo. So I think Insomniac are referencing a few different comic moments through this dark suit since they decided against the symbiote suit in the game. By the way, the reason we don't have the black symbiote suit as an alternate outfit is because Insomniac felt it deserved its time in the spotlight, and that it should be built up to instead of just used as a generic alternate costume. Now we know they were saving it for the sequel, but I do think there are a couple additional nods to it in this game as well. For example, there are billboards around the city that say, "Get into the black." There's also this interaction between Yuri and Spider-Man.
So, why'd you call? Need a date to the policeman's ball?
You got a black and white suit? No ball this year anyway.
We can also find this banner about symbiosis during the MJ mission in Grand Central Terminal. But after donning our new suit from Black Cat, Yuri calls in to tell us that Felicia managed to rob the police station and retrieve all of her gear. Apparently, all the Black Cat dolls we've been collecting in the city were set to deactivate nearby alarms after being placed in the same room together, which allowed her to easily sneak in and steal her gear. She played Peter really good, and it shows just how crafty Black Cat is. She's an expert at manipulation in general, but due to their history, Spider-Man is an easy target when it comes to her. By the way, I'm not sure if this is just a reused asset or another joke regarding Black Cat's thief skills, but on her workbench is also a jar with a few cents in it labeled New Laptop Money. This is likely the same one from the beginning of the game in Peter's apartment, so I guess Black Cat even stole that. Along with these few cents, she also left all her stolen loot, about $50 million worth. So it's clear she has something bigger up her sleeve, which brings us to the DLC. It begins with a voiceover from MJ describing how Fisk's arrest has created a power vacuum in the city that she believes the various Magia crime families will attempt to fill by taking out the others. MJ's first tip to Spider-Man is about a stolen painting called the Maria, which has ended up in a museum. Apparently, this painting is of importance to one of the families, and they're attempting to steal it back tonight. When we arrive, we see that MJ's source was correct, as Magia goons are attempting to break in. Peter recognizes that these are Hammerhead's men, and we'll see Hammerhead himself later on. But after taking them all out, Spider-Man decides to check inside the building just to make sure there aren't any stragglers. Instead of Magia goons, he finds someone else.
Yeah, I am gonna have to call you right back.
Why? What's going on?
You look good. Been working out?
No. I mean, you know, a little.
So, you swinging solo now, or back with your ex?
That's a lot of questions.
I'm just curious.
Yeah, I hear that's bad for cats. How about you tell me why you're really here?
I was just waiting for the right moment.
This could also be a slight nod to the Spider-Man 2 movie game, where Black Cat's first appearance was also in an art museum. Regardless, Black Cat uses us to distract the Magia while she attempts to steal the painting. When we return back to her, she surprisingly destroys it, revealing a hidden thumb drive inside. Black Cat then points out that a sculpture is about to fall on some goons, forcing Spider-Man to save them, and in that time, Black Cat escapes. As we swing through the city, MJ calls to tell us that it's rumored that Hammerhead now has the drive, and that the rest of the Magia Dons are freaked out about it. This means Black Cat must be working for Hammerhead, but the question is why? We next catch up to Black Cat as she flees a building for more Magia guards. She reveals that she's recovered another thumb drive, and it seems that she's stealing one from each of the Magia families for Hammerhead. Still confused about her motivations, Spider-Man asks her why she's stolen the drive, to which she responds with this bombshell.
Then why are you stealing it?
If I don't, they'll kill my son.
Wait, your son?
Based on Peter and Felicia's prior relationship, them having a son together is entirely possible and adds another layer of stress that Peter wasn't ready for. To help him ease his mind, he decides to focus on preventing the gang war that Hammerhead's about to start. So he calls MJ and she gives him a tip on a potential lead. She also tells him to be on guard and not let Felicia play him again.
Yeah, I'll be on guard. I don't know. She just seems to bring bad luck wherever she goes.
Black Cat brings bad luck? That's a little on the nose, Pete.
This bad luck conversation is a nod to Black Cat's powers in the comics. In her first appearances, she was just a normal cat burglar with no powers. She was just incredibly talented at thievery and manipulation. That all changed as she started to team up with Spider-Man and struggled to hold her own against these superpowered villains they regularly went up against. This made Black Cat more of a liability in a fight, at least in Spider-Man's eyes, since he felt that a lot of his focus went towards keeping her safe, sometimes preventing him from stopping the villain when he otherwise could have. This created a rift between them, and Felicia decided to seek out someone who could give her abilities. She actually requested help from the Avengers and the Fantastic Four first, but they wouldn't help her. So she settled for a mysterious benefactor who was successfully able to give her abilities. This is where she got her bad luck powers, which essentially work by giving everyone around her bad luck, providing her with an upper hand during fights. What Felicia didn't initially know was that her powers were funded by the Kingpin, who wanted to use her as a Trojan horse type of attack against Spider-Man. Since it's later learned that Felicia's bad luck powers affect people the more she's around them, and with her dating Spider-Man, it started to affect him significantly. For example, one time he forgot how to fire his web shooters while wearing the symbiote costume, causing him to fall and nearly injure himself. Spider-Man eventually suspected some kind of hex had been placed on him, so he sought out Doctor Strange. Strange was able to remove the hex, which also inadvertently removed the bad luck powers from Black Cat. Her powers have changed a few times in the comics since then, and she's even managed to get her bad luck abilities back, but with more control over them. For example, Felicia sought out Doc Trauma after losing her powers, and Trauma grafted a quantum probability pulsator onto her, allowing her to cause bad luck to those in her area. She also bought a suit from the Tinkerer, which enhanced her physical abilities. For example, boosting her strength and speed, but also giving her sharp claws. In the game's bio for Black Cat, it seems she's wearing a similar suit since it mentions her having superhuman agility and that she draws additional strength from the suit. It's unclear to me if she's meant to have bad luck powers in the game though. The bio is written from Peter's point of view and he mentions again that she brings bad luck wherever she goes. In my opinion, I've always just taken this as a fun nod to the comics, and in reality it's just that she's a thrill seeker who puts herself in dangerous situations, so bad things tend to happen around her. I think it's left obscure enough that she could have powers, but my interpretation is that this is a more grounded Black Cat. But getting back to the story, MJ later calls to tell us what she's learned about the Magia. By the way, in case there's any confusion, the Magia are a syndicate of mobsters, basically the Mafia, and the Magia is comprised of 5 independent crime families. Apparently, to help keep the peace between them all, they agreed to use a joint accounting database, essentially holding all of their assets in one place. Each family received their own drive for it, and it takes all 5 drives together to access it. It seems Hammerhead's plan was to use Black Cat to steal all the drives, allowing him to take all the money for himself while bankrupting the other families. At this time, Felicia only needs one more drive to complete the set, which we see she's already obtained when we find her. Peter attempts to talk to her, but Felicia quickly hits him with an EMP blast, which shorts out his web shooters. This leads to a fun gameplay section where we have to chase Black Cat without the aid of web swinging. Usually, I'm not a huge fan of chase sequences, but I thought this was really cool, thanks primarily to how strong the parkour animations are. From a gameplay standpoint, I'm not doing much, just holding R2 while pushing the stick forward, but I love seeing Spider-Man do flips around all the obstacles in his path. This is a pretty short sequence too, so I think it lasts for just the right amount of time. I think this is also a cool sequence for Black Cat that further displays her abilities and cunning, like her being able to mostly outrun Spider-Man's superhuman speed. I also really like the moment we catch up to her, where we're given the option to tackle her. When Spider-Man goes for it, she quickly grabs him and flips him over her shoulder, and then follows it up by dropping a smoke grenade on him. So overall, I'm really enjoying these displays of Black Cat skills. We've only seen her in a few short cutscenes so far, but already she's stealing the show for me. I love the mystery and intrigue surrounding her heists and motivations, as well as watching her continually get the upper hand on everyone she goes against. The playful flirting is pretty funny too. So far, this is my favorite interpretation of Black Cat in a game, at least as far as the ones we've covered on the channel, since I can't really speak to the others. But eventually, Black Cat hops aboard a tram as it takes off, and luckily for Spider-Man, this is when his web shooters reactivate.
Shooter's finally rebooted. It's thwippin' time!
It's thwippin' time is a nice little callback to the part 1 video on a post-it note where Peter's workshopping catchphrases. In that case, it's webbin' time. We'll next follow Black Cat's train out in the open, where she jumps off to continue our chase. Part of Black Cat's gear is a concealed grappling hook, which she uses to traverse the city. So even with our web shooters back, she's still a challenge to catch up to. Our best hope is to get close and fire webbing at her to slow her down. However, this also slows us down and provides her an opportunity to launch another stun grenade at us, so I like how evenly matched the two of them are during this chase. Spider-Man manages to catch up to her though, and even gets a moment to talk to her. He tells her that he wants to help her find her son, and that if she gives Hammerhead that last drive, he likely won't keep her son alive. Black Cat agrees, and they decide to work together. She tells him that she can stall Hammerhead for a couple of days, and that she'll be in touch. Unfortunately for Peter, she also refuses to discuss whether he's the father of her son or not until after they save him. We eventually get a call from Black Cat to check out a bar that she believes is holding something valuable to Hammerhead. We'll start clearing out the area solo while Black Cat investigates Hammerhead's files in the building. Eventually, Hammerhead's men realize Spider-Man's here, so more come out to rush us. Black Cat then swoops in to help, leading to a really awesome combat encounter where she fights alongside us. She's not exactly fighting shoulder to shoulder with us, but instead she'll perch up high and watch us fight, occasionally dropping a grenade in the area. Or she'll pounce on suspecting goons to take them out. It's nothing too intricate, but it's fun having some assistance during the fight, and it's cool seeing Black Cat pop in to help us clear out some enemies. After taking out the last of them, Black Cat decides to unwind with some wine, which leads to a cutscene that I really enjoy. By the way, the scene has a good, clear example of Black Cat's audio theme, which I also want to highlight because it's one of my favorites in the game. I really like how her theme evokes her sense of mischievousness, and pairing that with her breaking all the wine bottles for no reason, you easily get the idea that she's trouble. She may be on our side right now, but she's pretty chaotic. I wanted to highlight this brief section because it's little subtle character moments like this that I really enjoy in games, where you're given a small window into somebody's personality through their actions. It's also a good example of show don't tell in storytelling, which is something I think Insomniac really excelled at in the main game, most notably with Octavius and his slow turn to villainy. Insomniac also excel at character building, and I think they've done so again with Black Cat in making her a really intriguing anti-hero. We know she's bad news, but there's also something really captivating about her. I think it's how she embraces the danger of her lifestyle and how much fun she seems to have doing so. I also find her and Peter's relationship really fascinating. During this scene, she mentions that she legitimately tried to go straight for a while, abandoning the Black Cat life and even working a normal job. It's tough to know how much of what she says is true at any moment, but I could see her trying the normal life for a bit to please Peter, since she's tried to ditch her life of crime to please him in the comics as well. Of course, it never sticks. I also like how they both seem to try to pull the other to their side in their interactions. Peter wants Felicia to change her ways and be good, while Felicia wants Peter to embrace his darker side. I really like this tug of war between them, and it's helping me further engage in the story. But from here, Black Cat leaves, and we continue our investigation into possible locations her son could be hidden. Our next lead brings us to a Hammerhead-owned shipyard in Hell's Kitchen. Spider-Man suspects that a kid could be held in any one of these storage containers, so him and Black Cat decide to search the area. This begins a unique stealth sequence where we can command Black Cat to take out enemies when needed. I thought this was a cool mechanic, and I enjoyed the additional options it provided to stealth. For example, it was fun trying to time our takedown so we take out two enemies at once. I also liked how it allowed us to cover additional ground, where I could have her take out an enemy in one location while I head to another area. I mostly like this mechanic as a good foundation to build upon though. If I'm being honest, as much as I like this mechanic, it didn't feel necessary in this mission. You could just take everyone out here yourself if you want and totally ignore Black Cat. Although admittedly, it is faster to use her in this section. In future games though, I'd like to see our allies feel like more of a necessity in missions like this. For example, maybe there are enemies that you both have to take down together, or maybe there are enemies that she specifically has to take out based on a gadget or ability that she has that Spider-Man doesn't. In this DLC, it's good for what it is, since it's more just the novelty of having her help us, and I appreciate it on that fundamental level, but I hope Insomniac build on this mechanic for future games. From here, Spider-Man begins checking the shipping containers. He doesn't find a child, but instead finds a stolen shipment of weapons from Silver Sable's military. Afterwards, he goes into the building to check on Black Cat. Inside, he finds Hammerhead's vault door open, containing even more Sable weapons, but also a box with a missing thumb drive in it. Just then, the vault door closes, and Black Cat reveals that she's played Peter once again. She doesn't actually have a son, she only told Peter that so he'd help her when she needed it. She also played Hammerhead too, though. He hired her to track down all the drives, but she's been giving him fake drives the entire time, keeping the real ones for herself.
The entire wealth of the Magia. In the palm of my hand.
A nice little nod to the Spider-Man 2 movie there.
The power of the sun. In the palm of my hand.
From here, Black Cat leaves Spider-Man in the vault as she flees with the drive. Hammerhead's men show up and Peter clings to the ceiling to watch them. Once they realize the drive's been stolen, they call Hammerhead to see what he wants to do. He tells them that the drive has a tracker in it, which he'll use to find Felicia and kill her. He also mentions that he's rigged her penthouse with a bomb, which he'll detonate if she shows up. With their orders, the men leave, and Spider-Man decides to call Black Cat to warn her. She doesn't seem too bothered by the information and pretty much writes it off as nothing to worry about. Spider-Man doesn't agree and rushes to her penthouse to save her.
Felicia!
Before we continue, there are a couple things I want to discuss about that scene. By the looks of it, Felicia got caught in the blast and is presumably dead. In DLC 3, though, we learn that that's not the case. So how did she survive? Well, if you slow down the footage, you can actually see that before the blast goes off, she first pops a smoke grenade to conceal herself. We can't see much after that as the explosion then goes off, but if I were to guess, she probably has some kind of trap door in that welcome mat area or something like that. So it makes a lot more sense why Black Cat wasn't worried about a bomb going off here. In fact, she planned ahead for it and embraced it, so she'd be presumed dead and off everyone's radar. Pretty clever, and I love how Black Cat is conning everyone left and right, even the player, as I'm sure many fans weren't sure if she managed to survive that blast. Or at least at first glance, it's hard to see how she would be able to survive that blast. Then of course, there's our first shot of Hammerhead, the Magia Don who's been orchestrating the beginning of a gang war. With Black Cat seemingly out of the picture, we'll follow him through the next two DLC stories. But before that, we get a small post-credit scene of Peter and MJ at a restaurant discussing Black Cat's death as well as Peter's relief that he's not a father. Although, neither of them are opposed to the idea in the future.
I think you're gonna be an amazing dad someday. At the right time.
With the right person.
As we discussed in part one, Peter and MJ do have a child in the comics, Mayday Parker. So that could very likely be in this Peter's future as well, and this post-credit scene could be a fun one to look back on around the time of, like, Spider-Man 3, since I could see May introduced around that time if the writers decide to go that route, and assuming the series goes for a trilogy. But now, let's get into DLC 2. It starts in a similar way to the first one, with a corkboard filled with information on the Magia. This time, though, it's not MJ narrating over it, it's Captain Yuri Watanabe. After losing Black Cat and the thumb drives, Hammerhead has resorted to taking down the other Magia families through force, arming his men with stolen Sable weapons. The gang wars have begun, and New York is caught in the crossfire. Thankfully, Yuri's learned that the Magia have Hammerhead pinned down in an old Harlem sanitarium, which is where the story picks up.
Ready when you are.
Copy that. I'll get him looking the wrong way. You gentlemen ready?
Spidey, check it out.
Nice.
That's not regulation, Lieutenant.
Sorry, Captain. Birthday present from the kid. Not every day you run ops with the man, you know?
I'll let it slide. This time. Now get back on the ready line.
Yes, ma'am.
Let's do this.
The plan is to have Spider-Man directly engage the Magia in a fight, while Yuri and her men quietly break into the building to apprehend Hammerhead. During the fight, I also enjoyed this little Captain America reference.
You know, I know a guy with a way cooler shield!
That's not the only reference to Captain America, since he and Iron Man are also referenced in Otto Octavius' game bio. There's also a nod to the Wasp and Vulture's profile, so it's cool seeing these little references to the Avengers within the game, and it kind of gives us an idea of the team's roster in this universe. Of course, there's also Avengers Tower, which we'll look at more in the open world section of this video. After the fight, and not having heard from Yuri, Spider-Man decides to head inside to check things out. Along the way, he finds a board, or more like a hit list, regarding the other Magiadons. At the top left is Caesar Cicero. In the comics, he was a member of Silvermane's Magia family, and we'll discuss Silvermane a bit more later. At the top right is Don Fortunato. When Peter sees his photo here, he recalls hearing rumors that the Don's son is trying to get out of the family business. This is true in the comics as well. The son's name is Giacomo Fortunato, nicknamed Jimmy Six. He didn't agree with the family's methods and attempted to get out, going on the run. Don Fortunato's response was to send men after his son, and this led to shootouts in the streets. Ben Reilly Spider-Man saved Jimmy from one of these shootouts, and even formed a minor friendship. Ben even let Jimmy hide out at his apartment for a time, although he soon regretted it since Jimmy was a very sloppy roommate. Jimmy Six seems to be a good guy overall though, looking out for others and teaming up with vigilantes, so it's cool to see him get a nod in the game. There's also Don Machio, although I'm not familiar with him from the comics and couldn't find anything on him. In the game, Peter just mentions that he gets really creative with his killings. Lastly is Don Costa.
Don Costa. Ordered hits on a lot of innocent families. Dude should be punished.
Peter saying he should be punished is a nod to the Costa family's ties to the Punisher, since it was the Costas who ordered the hit on Frank Castle's family. So I wonder if the Castles are one of the families Peter's referring to here. Man, now I want a Punisher game where he hunts them all down. In this room, you can also find a jukebox. It doesn't sound interesting, but if you examine it closer in photo mode, you can see the band and track names are references to various Spider-Man comics. For example, Six Losers is a reference to the Sinister Six, and the track names are all associated with the Sinister Six in some way. Like the Old Buzzard is a nod to Vulture, Thrill of the Hunt is for Kraven, Fishbowl Illusionist is Mysterio, and then another example is Secret Battle in reference to Secret Wars, with relevant track lists such as The Beyonder and Welcome to Battle World. Also, there's Maximum Rampage instead of Maximum Carnage, with track lists like A Man Named Cassidy, as in Cletus Cassidy, and Escape from Ravencroft, which is the institution he was being held in at the beginning of the story. I won't go through each of these since there's a lot of them, but it's a really cool Easter egg and a very easy one to miss. Continuing on, we soon learn Yuri and her men have been captured by Hammerhead, and he's given a pretty intense introduction.
That's the problem with your new cops. No respect.
This is just the beginning, as Hammerhead feels the need to monologue quite a bit to Yuri in this moment. It's effective though, and just these early scenes show us that Hammerhead is a ruthless and twisted killer, but let's also take a moment to discuss Hammerhead's origins in the comics. Even though he's part of the Italian mob, he was actually born Russian. His father was a vicious man and would beat him with a hammer. This left intense scarring on his head, something he was made fun of for in school, and also earned him the nickname Hammerhead. Even though he was Russian, he had a fascination with Italian mobsters and would portray himself as Italian. Later in life, he was given a chance to prove himself to the Magia and was sent to kill a young couple, the same ones who made fun of him in school. To do the job, he used a hammer on them. He was also present for another hit, this one on his father. Hammerhead decided to do the job himself using, you guessed it, a hammer. At one point though, Hammerhead himself was beaten nearly to death in an alleyway to the point he lost his memory of his past. The last thing he saw before passing out was a poster for a movie about the Al Capone mob. Shortly after this, he was found in the alley by a surgeon named Jonas Harrow. Jonas was able to save his life and also replaced the shattered bone in his head with steel alloy. Without any knowledge of his past, Hammerhead clung to the last memory he had, which was that movie poster, so he based his identity around it, essentially a 1920s mobster, which is why you'll often see him in pinstripe suits and wielding a Tommy gun. As far as the game goes, the bio confirms the part about being found in an alley by Jonas Harrow and having the steel plate put in his head. Returning back to the cutscene, Hammerhead continues his torment of the police by turning his attention to Lieutenant Drake, the same cop we saw earlier who was wearing a Spider-Man watch gifted to him by his child. We get a great display of Yuri's skill here when she notices the guards are too focused on Hammerhead. She manages to disarm the one closest to her, but Lieutenant Drake is too beat up to match her speed. The result is a standoff between Yuri and Hammerhead, with Drake caught in the middle. Yuri really wants to take the shot, but knows it's too risky for Drake, and probably wouldn't kill Hammerhead due to the plate in his head. Thankfully, Spider-Man swoops in to disarm Hammerhead. The lights are shot out, leading to a firefight in the dark between Yuri and the henchmen as Hammerhead flees. After Hammerhead's guards are taken out, Yuri and Spider-Man check on Lieutenant Drake. Sadly, it seems he was shot in the crossfire and died. The camera then slowly zooms in on the watch, now with a thin crack in the glass. Okay, so as sadistic as this probably sounds, I really love this cutscene and really this level as a whole due to how well it builds up multiple characters and sets the tone for the rest of the DLC. First, it serves as a great introduction to Hammerhead and reminds me a lot of Negan's introduction in the Walking Dead series, the way he also had a group of hostages that he slowly threatened to stoke fear in the others. They feel so similar to me that I wouldn't even be surprised if that scene was used as inspiration for Hammerhead's here too. Regardless, we get a great sense of how ruthless and cocky Hammerhead is, and how important it is that he be stopped as soon as possible. We're also made to hate Hammerhead thanks to the tragic character Lieutenant Drake. We only get a very small introduction to him at the beginning of the level, but his excitement towards working with Spider-Man was refreshing, and it's sweet seeing him wear the Spider-Man watch that his kid gave him. Having him then die on the same mission feels really tragic and unfair, and was effective at making Hammerhead's villainy feel more personal. The final zoom-in shot of the watch drives that home, and it felt very sad and thought-provoking. For example, for me, it made me think of Lieutenant Drake's kid. To me, the crack in the glass over Spider-Man's face felt symbolic of Spider-Man's fractured image from the perspective of Lieutenant Drake's child who idolized Spider-Man. Spider-Man wasn't able to save their dad, so I'm sure this event will shake their faith in him moving forward. The fractured perspective of Spider-Man could also extend to Yuri, as we'll see throughout the rest of the DLC story, and this moment is especially pivotal for her moving forward. Even though Lieutenant Drake is our focus, Yuri just lost her whole squad on this mission. She's also probably mad at herself for not taking that shot against Hammerhead when she had the chance, knowing that Drake died anyway. This event marks the beginning of a turn in Yuri's character, and she has one of my favorite arcs throughout this DLC series, so we'll discuss her more in depth as we continue. After this incident, Spider-Man tells Yuri that he'll handle things. She needs to rest and call the families of her fallen men, so she agrees. Spider-Man's first stop is the Bar with No Name, a bar known as a criminal hangout. Spider-Man decides to deploy one of his spider-bots to infiltrate it to eavesdrop on different Magia thugs. Inside the bar are some fun details as well. First, the bar is meant to be a neutral zone with rules like no guns, no fighting, no powers. You even have to check in your weapons before you can enter the bar. Still, I like how the bartenders are equipped for anyone potentially breaking these rules, since while you're exploring, you can find a pistol hidden behind the beer taps. I mentioned Negan from The Walking Dead earlier, and his trademark weapon is a bat with barbed wire wrapped around it. You can find multiple of these hidden behind the bar as well. It may or may not be a reference to the show, but I still think it's cool to see that despite the rules, the bartenders know their clientele and are ready for a fight. There are also a couple pinball machines in the bar, one for the villain Electro and one for Kingpin. What I love most is that they're based on the classic comics and feature their original outfits. I thought these were such a cool Easter egg and they look like a lot of fun to play. Through his eavesdropping though, Spider-Man learns that all the Magia Dons are currently hiding out in the Auerbach Theater and that he needs to reach them before Hammerhead does. When he arrives, he realizes that he's already too late and that they're now in Hammerhead's possession. Spider-Man calls Yuri to tell her the bad news and she's pretty pissed. He told her he would handle things and he hasn't, so she decides she needs to be more hands-on with the situation. We'll next speak to her in person after Hammerhead mounts an attack on the police station. He stole all the Sable military equipment he could and killed anyone who got in his way. We also learn that he was specifically seeking out Sable equipment marked Project Olympus, which we'll learn more about later. For now, Yuri is even more upset and has a personal vendetta against Hammerhead. She decides she needs to bring the fight to him and wants to do things herself. Spider-Man tries to cool her off, but she's not having it. She's flying solo, and Spider-Man knows he needs to find Hammerhead before she does, or else she'll likely kill him. Shortly after this conversation, Spider-Man learns of a shootout at the Bar with No Name. When he arrives, it looks like a scene left behind by the Punisher. The place is littered with bullet holes, shell casings, and there are dead criminals everywhere. It's brutal, but shows how capable Yuri is, even by herself. Thankfully for Spider-Man, one of the criminals left behind their phone, which gives him a lead on Hammerhead, including that he has something big planned tonight. After more eavesdropping, Spider-Man learns the location of the event, which is a construction site. When Spider-Man arrives, he finds all the Magia Dons tied up in a hole while Hammerhead's men pour cement into it, and all of this is being broadcasted on live TV. Spider-Man needs to rescue the Magia Dons, and this leads to a fun combat sequence where you have to fight off all of Hammerhead's men while also preventing them from turning the cement truck back on. If you fail, the Dons will drown in the cement. When you save them, police will show up to help free them, while Spider-Man turns his attention to Hammerhead. We'll swing to the top of the construction site where we find Hammerhead waiting for us, but now he's decked out in armor plating, which was part of the Project Olympus Sable equipment that he stole earlier. Hammerhead is still broadcasting live and wants to defeat Spider-Man to show how powerful he is, as well as make the Magia feared again like the old days. We'll now have to fight Hammerhead while he's powered up by the armored suit, and this gives him the ability to fly at us, and he even has a laser he can fire. It's still Hammerhead though, so I like that he often uses his head as a battering ram, a common attack of his in the comics as well. This fight wasn't anything too crazy, but I thought it was still challenging and Hammerhead felt powerful. After dealing enough damage to him, he'll have to take a knee, giving the police enough time to swarm the area. Hammerhead takes the opportunity to monologue some more to Spider-Man, and I like that Yuri interrupts it with a shot to the back. She has no intention of stopping there either, stepping forward and launching a device to subdue Spider-Man so he won't get in her way. I also love how at this moment, Hammerhead's facial expression turns to pure fear as he realizes that she has every intention to kill him on the spot. He attempts to get away, but she shoots him into a corner. She's able to get up close now, and I like how she points the gun so it'll fire up and under the metal plate in his head. As she pulls the trigger, Spider-Man breaks free and fires a web in just enough time to pull the gun away, preventing a kill shot. Still, the shot grazes his head, revealing the metal plate under the skin as Hammerhead passes out. Spider-Man and the police stand together watching Yuri, and I like this visual separation of them. At this moment, Yuri is no longer on the side of the police, and now that Spider-Man has interfered, he's not a direct ally to her either. The screen then fades to black, as that concludes DLC 2. Well, sort of, as we get another post-credit scene showing Hammerhead being driven away in an ambulance. One of the medics is an undercover henchman who uses a stun gun to reawaken Hammerhead. This takes us to DLC 3, which opens like the other two, except we're back to MJ reporting. After the events of the last DLC, Yuri was placed on administrative leave from the police department. As far as Hammerhead, the public is aware that he's alive, but no one knows where he is. His men are still targeting Project Olympus equipment, which was a project funded by Sable and Oscorp to create super soldiers. MJ later states that Project Olympus was part of Sable's agreement to help Osborn during the Devil's Breath crisis, and her intention was to ship Project Olympus back to Simkaria. Simkaria is currently dealing with a very violent civil war, and Sable needs these weapons to stop it. In fact, Silver Sable even returns during this DLC to end the raids on her equipment and reclaim it for her people. She wants information on Hammerhead and threatens Spider-Man for that intel. Spider-Man doesn't like that she's pointing guns at him for info, and offers to talk to her if she puts them away, to which she declines. This leads to a fight between the two, which initially felt kind of unnecessary and shoehorned in, but I can go with it based on Sable's established personality. As we discussed in the part 1 video, Sable being a hard ass is understandable based on her origins, where she was trained by her father to be mission focused and to not let emotions get in the way. Getting these weapons for her people is also extremely important to her, so it makes sense that she doesn't want to waste any time and wants answers now. As far as the fight itself, I thought it was fun but still pretty tough. This makes sense though due to how skilled Sable is. Her skills are on great display here too. For example, the way she shoots your webs out of the air if you fire them at her. If you attempt a melee combo over 3 hits, she'll counter you and throw you to the ground. So it can be tough to land hits on her, and I found her to be pretty difficult to gain momentum on, but I like that for her character. During the fight, the two of them will speak, and we learn that Sable blames Spider-Man for allowing her equipment to be stolen. He's supposed to be protecting the city, and in her eyes, he's doing a poor job. She intends to find Hammerhead herself, and wants Spider-Man to stay out of the way. The moment is quickly interrupted when a captured Hammerhead thug escapes, prompting Sable to pursue him in her jet. By the way, Sable has a plane like this in the comics too, and it's able to cloak itself, which we'll see it do in the game later as well. Sable will spend a lot of time in her jet during this DLC, as we'll see in the next couple sections. Spider-Man eventually tracks down another heist of Project Olympus equipment and chases the fleeing vehicle through the city. Before he gets a chance to stop it, Sable flies in and blows up part of its entourage. Now, Peter has to chase down Sable's jet as it pursues the Hammerhead truck and try to prevent as much additional collateral damage as possible. I thought this was a pretty unique chase sequence, and it's cool to see Sable's jet flying down the streets of New York. The coolest part though is definitely when you get to perch on one of these wings and web shoot drones. Sable eventually manages to destroy the truck and hops out to interrogate the driver. He's not giving her any info, which causes her to get more aggressive. Spider-Man interrupts her interrogation and again offers to team up and find Hammerhead together. This time, Sable agrees, but uses a handshake to place a tracker on Spider-Man before flying off once again. Spider-Man continues his investigation and tracks down a man named Tony, who's higher up in Hammerhead's organization. Tony tells Spider-Man that Hammerhead wants to have a meeting with Silver Sable. At that moment, Sable actually shows up out of nowhere and agrees to the meeting. They both know it's a trap, but Sable doesn't care. As Spider-Man predicted, it was most definitely a trap, and Sable's jet is locked in place and unable to move. We decide to help her out anyway, and destroy some generators to set her free. Then we work together to clear the area of Hammerhead goons. Before we can make our exit, Hammerhead shows up in person, and we can see that he's used Project Olympus to give himself a robot body. If he seemed indestructible last time, he's looking straight up invincible now. Also, is this giving anyone else flashbacks to Marvel Ultimate Alliance 2 with Robot Nick Fury? This feels like a similar twist, and honestly, I have similar opinions about it here, but we'll get into that more towards the end of the DLC. For now, I want to talk about how this relates to the comics, because Hammerhead hasn't gone through this drastic of a change before, although he has been enhanced. For example, during the Civil War series, Hammerhead was shot in the head with an adamantium bullet. The bullet didn't penetrate his skull, but he was still close to death. He was saved by Mr. Negative of all people, who had Doc Trauma do surgery on him and provide him with a metal skeleton for the upper half of his body. Mr. Negative's motivation was to make Hammerhead his new enforcer, and it worked, and Hammerhead was even stronger and more durable than before. However, he didn't look like a robot person. There was another time, however, that I think more closely resembles the game. At one point, Hammerhead had an exoskeleton built for him by the Tinkerer to increase his strength and durability. The Human Torch was easily able to render it useless, though, after burning through its power source. Hammerhead had it repaired and used it again against Ben Reilly Spider-Man. So this at least goes to show that it's not out of character for Hammerhead to seek out artificial enhancements to even the odds against superheroes. And although the comics set a precedent for Hammerhead using armor, I think Insomniac are taking it a step further by fusing Hammerhead with the comic character Silvermane. Silvermane was a Magia Don in the comics, and the one responsible for the experiments that led to the powers of Cloak and Dagger and Mr. Negative. Cloak and Dagger wanted revenge, and Dagger cut Silvermane's life support tubes while he laid in bed, despite Spider-Man's attempts to stop them. Believing him dead, they left. However, he wasn't quite dead yet, and one of his men, a doctor, stole him away and began to attempt to save his life. His solution was to give Silvermane a bionic body as a temporary vessel until they found a way to make him human again. Silvermane didn't want a human body anymore though, since he was exhilarated by this new strength in his robot body. As you can see, Silvermane's body closely resembles Hammerhead's in the game, so I think Insomniac are blending the two characters. In the game, Hammerhead is still just as relentless as before, but even more powerful. Sable and Spider-Man do their best to fight him off, but he's able to easily overwhelm them. He even manages to grab them at the same time and readies himself to provide the killing blow via a headbutt. Before he can, Black Cat shows up and whisks Spider-Man to safety. Sable's plane begins to free fall, and both her and Hammerhead fall to the ground. Both of them survive, but Hammerhead manages to capture Silver Sable and leave with her. Meanwhile, Spider-Man gets a moment to speak with Black Cat, and she provides him with some game-changing information.
Did you honestly think I was dead?
How did you find me?
Same way she did. Watch out. That girl has trust issues.
How long have you been watching me? Watching us?
Long enough to know you're making a mistake. Hammerhead's gotten too powerful.
Do you really think I have a choice?
Here.
Wait, is that?
Everything you need to know about that ugly thing. Sorry for what I did to you. But now we're even. One more thing. His head? Not as strong as you think it is.
It's great to see Black Cat return, and I love how she always seems to have the upper hand, even in situations unrelated to her. This is the last that we'll see of her in the first game, and I hope we see more of her in the sequel. Using Black Cat's intel, we learn that Hammerhead has been stashing all his stolen Sable tech underground, which is likely where he's holding Silver Sable, so we head there next. When Peter calls MJ to fill her in, she has surprising news of her own. She says she's been fascinated by the revolution occurring in Simkaria and feels that too many countries have been ignoring the problem. So she's decided to head to Simkaria and document everything going on in hopes of making it more public and possibly getting Simkaria additional aid. It's a noble pursuit, and even though Peter doesn't like the idea of her heading into a war zone, he trusts her and agrees she should go. So I thought this was a good moment that furthers MJ's arc from the main game in a positive way. This is the type of work that she's been dying to do, and shows how she's a hero in her own right. I also think it shows the growth between Peter and MJ's relationship, as Peter now supports her in these decisions instead of fighting her on it. Continuing on, Peter heads into the sewers to find Sable. Through his search, he finds their main base of operations and a bunch of Sable equipment. We also learn that Hammerhead's plan has been to lure Silver Sable back to New York so he can get his hands on all her best equipment. We also soon find Sable as she's being tortured. Spider-Man shows up at the right time to free her, and she takes revenge on her captor, even with what must be a really painful drill injury. Sable appreciates Spider-Man's help, but still wants to work alone. As a last-ditch effort, he shows her the drive that Black Cat gave him. Enemies, of course, then arrive to fight them, and they decide to team up to take them out. Up until now, she's really just been in her plane the whole time, so it's nice having Sable on the ground and fighting alongside us. After defeating Hammerhead's men, Sable and Spider-Man use a computer to analyze the information on the drive. While scouring it, they discover a weakness. The plate inside Hammerhead's head is susceptible to heat. Sable has an idea on how to use that to her advantage and says that she'll call Spider-Man when she's ready. It seems that she's at least somewhat willing to give the team up a try, and as she walks off, she even gives a little smirk, showing that she's warming up to Spider-Man. Shortly after this, Sable calls and gives us a location to meet her. When we arrive, she's waiting in her plane and gives us a ride to a secret base that she has on the water. It's been here this whole time, but cloaked so well that nobody knew it was there. Now that she's uncloaked it, she expects Hammerhead to show up at any minute. Sable's plan is to outfit her jet with a laser that will heat the plate in Hammerhead's skull enough to soften it, giving her an opportunity to knock him unconscious. We'll get to test her theory out very soon, since as predicted, Hammerhead has shown up on board and is looking for a fight. He'll get it as we fight him on the deck while Sable gets prepared. We'll fight Hammerhead like normal, dodging his attacks and webbing him up, while damaging the cybernetics in his knees enough to ground him for a second. While grounded, Spider-Man holds his head in position for Sable to shoot her laser, superheating the metal plate. We're then given a moment to beat up Hammerhead while he's vulnerable. We'll follow this pattern a couple more times before moving on to the next phase. Hammerhead boosts his durability with an energy field, but Sable has bombs that can deactivate it. During the fight, she'll drop a wave of bombs down, allowing us to throw one directly at Hammerhead to remove the shield. Then we continue the fight as normal. Overall, I thought this fight was pretty solid for the most part. Hammerhead is really strong and fast, and I often felt on the ropes against him, especially towards the end. It's also just always fun having Spider-Man go up against enemies that outclass him in size and power to see how he overcomes it, so I thought this was a fitting final battle. This was also a pretty cool team-up fight, and it's nice having Sable in her plane providing air support. So I'm ultimately pretty positive on this final battle. During one of the team-ups though, Sable's laser malfunctions, forcing her to improvise. Her solution is to fly the plane into Hammerhead. Sable and Spider-Man both dodge out of the way in time, while the plane collides with Hammerhead, resulting in a huge explosion. Out of the flames walks Hammerhead, and it initially seems like he might be just as invincible as he claims. That's until his cybernetics begin to short out, and Hammerhead collapses. It seems he's finally down for the count and no longer a threat. With the mission complete, Sable tells Spider-Man that she needs to return to Simkaria to help her people. However, she at least seems to finally consider Spider-Man an ally.
Thank you, Spider-Man. For everything. I don't do hugs.
Yeah, right. Of course. Hey, can I get a lift back to the city? I'd swim, but it'd take forever to get the river smell out of my suit.
And that ends the story of DLC 3. We still have one final post-credit scene though, and that's Peter training Miles on how to be Spider-Man. This lesson is on swinging through the city, and Peter tasks Miles with keeping up with him. Before making the leap, Miles pauses to take in the view, and we get a great shot of him overlooking the city. I think it's a great visual that teases his future as Spider-Man, although he still needs more training before that. And with that, our DLC story is complete. As far as this DLC series, I feel like it was overall a good experience, but I do think it struggled to maintain the quality standards of the main game, and I think the three individual DLCs varied in quality themselves. I enjoyed the Black Cat DLC the most, and I feel like it aligned with the quality of the main game the best. DLC 2 is pretty solid, but didn't hold my attention quite as well as the first one. DLC 3 slipped the farthest, and although I wouldn't call it a bad experience, it felt more middling compared to the rest of them. I think there are a few key reasons why these DLCs varied as well. To start, the main antagonist for the DLC series is Hammerhead, but each DLC story is headlined by its own female antihero, Black Cat, Yuri, and Silver Sable respectively. I think the first DLC was so gripping because Black Cat was such an intriguing character. A bunch of mystery surrounded her and everything she did, making her a lot of fun to watch. You never knew what would happen next when she was around. Her skills of deception were also excellently displayed, and it felt like she was always multiple steps ahead of both Spider-Man and the player. I think this DLC also did a great job setting up Hammerhead by having him constantly mentioned and alluded to without actually showing him until the end. So all around, I felt fully engrossed in the story and characters of DLC 1. DLC 2 felt similar, especially at the beginning, since those opening cutscenes did such a great job at engaging me in the story. Hammerhead felt like a true threat, and having him so callously take out Yuri's men set a great dramatic tone. The rest of DLC 2 wasn't quite as engaging in my opinion, but Yuri's story arc definitely was. We've spent so much time with her during the main game that I felt a bond to her character, and her turn into an anti-hero felt earned after witnessing her interactions with Hammerhead, so it was really exciting to see her take that initial experience and turn it against him.
There it is. There's the fear.
And we'll get him.
I know.
Where are you going?
To teach a lesson in fear.
Then with DLC 3, we have Silver Sable, and although I've liked her a lot in both the DLC and main story, I don't feel as much of a connection to her as I do Black Cat and Yuri. I think it's due to a couple reasons. The first is that she has such an isolated and cold personality that it can be difficult to empathize with her. She's very distant, and we the player can feel that distance emotionally as well. But beyond that, I think it's that we don't really know much about her and what drives her character. Basically, she doesn't have much of an arc. She shows up as a military leader to help Norman Osborn in the main game, and is kind of just doing her job. There's not a whole lot of depth there. I think the DLC tries to build on things a bit more with her ties to the Simkarian Civil War, giving her more of a personal motivation, but still it's tough to get invested in it because we're really just told about it. We never see Simkaria or its people suffering, so we kind of just go with it. However, we do come across a character named David Obademi, who was originally a teacher but has joined Sable's military in hopes of helping to secure humanitarian supplies for Simkaria. I like this character a lot, and I think he humanized the Simkarian struggle more, but I still wanted more from Sable herself. Admittedly, I think the original plan was for Sable to get a lot more development in the main game. In an interview with Kinda Funny Games, creative director Brian Inahar mentioned that originally, Sable had a bigger story arc that they had to cut. He says it was making things a bit too complicated, so they decided to cut it down to make things more digestible. I'm sure this was the right call for the quality of the game as a whole, but as it stands, I do think Sable's character depth is lacking overall. Sable isn't the only reason I'm hating on DLC 3 though. My other issue is how different it feels in tone compared to the other two. The first two DLCs were a lot more grounded, with street level threats and stakes that felt pretty realistic for the most part. Where I feel like DLC 3 went too far the other way, especially with Hammerhead. Him turning into a full-on robot man was a little too much of a sci-fi comic booky turn, even for a comic book game, since the previously established tone was more grounded. In going bigger, I think I lost my connection to the story and characters, to the point things started to feel more generic. So it's disappointing that the final DLC couldn't quite stick the landing, but I do think as a whole the DLC was pretty solid and was something that I was happy to have paid extra for. With the DLCs completed, I think it's best to next transition to the side missions in the game and begin with one of my favorite ones, which relates to Yuri Watanabe and what she's been up to since DLC 2. After saving Sable in the sewers, Spider-Man returns to the surface, only to find strands of dangling caution tape on a building. Upon further inspection, they lead to a chalk outline, along with a file and audio recording. We'll find multiple of these around the city, and the locations all relate to missing persons cases involving the Magia. As far as the contents of the tapes, the audio recordings are from therapy sessions between a Magia enforcer and his therapist.
Tell me a little bit more about your job. Describe a typical day.
Typical day? I guess it starts with waking up, checking my phone, see what the boss wants me to hit that day. Then I go grab breakfast. I've been trying to do that keto thing, you know? Then I do the hits. Sometimes it's messy, so I gotta head home and clean up. I try to get to the gym in the afternoon. And dinner and I...
Sorry, can you go back for a moment? What does do a hit mean exactly?
It means I kill who my boss tells me to. I'm pretty good at it by now.
The tapes only get crazier from here when the enforcer reveals that his reason for setting up this therapy session was really to threaten the therapist to do a job for them, or he'll kill his family. The therapist then reveals he assumed as much and requests money for the job. The job is for the therapist to record and leak his personal sessions with Captain Yuri Watanabe to the Magia. What we'll soon find out though is that Yuri actually anticipated this ahead of time and used an undercover officer to pose as her therapist. Sadly, the Magia enforcer wasn't so easily deceived and must have been following the therapist and caught him meeting up with Yuri, so he shot him in a coffee shop. So yeah, these tapes are quite a wild ride. But after listening to them all, Yuri calls Spider-Man and gives him a location to meet. When he arrives, he finds the Magia enforcer dead and tied up, surrounded by the case files of all the people that he killed.
This guy killed all these people. But does that mean he deserved to die? Yuri!
I know what you're gonna say, but just hear me out. The system works most of the time, but there are times when it doesn't. And to me, that's unacceptable. Some people put their trust in fate, or karma, or whatever. But I can only trust me.
You can't kill people, Yuri!
Apparently I can. And you know what? It felt good.
You need to turn yourself in.
For what? I just dispensed justice. True justice. And I restored a little bit of balance to the world.
You're my friend, Yuri. I don't want to come after you.
You do what you have to do, and I'll do what I have to do. Goodbye, Spider-Man.
Yuri! Tom, what am I gonna do?
Like I mentioned earlier, I'm a big fan of where Insomniac are taking Yuri, so let's talk about how it relates to the comics. So in the comics, Yuri goes through a similar transition. She starts as a police officer and ally to vigilante superheroes. She states that she was a friend of former police officer Jean DeWolf, who was murdered by the villain Sin Eater. However, it wasn't the police that caught Sin Eater, it was Daredevil and Spider-Man, and Yuri never forgot that. She also states that after certain events, like when a mass murderer named Massacre terrorized the city, she felt someone needed to start putting fear in criminals. So, she decided to do so as the vigilante Wraith. She stole some villain tech from Evidence Lockup, such as Mr. Fear's fear gas and some of Mysterio's tech, to give her a more spectral look like a ghost. However, Yuri was still a cop, and tried to abide by that other half of her life when she could. At one point, her precinct got a new police chief who wanted things done by the book. When Yuri tried to do things by the book, her mentor Teddy Wrangle was shot unexpectedly by the villain Tombstone. Tombstone was still apprehended and tried in court, but was able to bribe the judge to set him free, and Teddy later died from his injuries. This developed a harder edge in Yuri, and she started to become more ruthless as Wraith, leading Spider-Man to question her methods. Her tipping point was after being manipulated by Mr. Negative, she wanted revenge and stopped at nothing to get to him, including killing one of his men. Yuri was no longer a cop at the precinct, and stated that Yuri was no more, and that only the Wraith lives. So just from that, I'm sure you can already see some parallels between her comic origin and her game origin. Things like losing a close police officer during a raid, and watching criminals repeatedly get away with crimes, pushing her over the edge. Also, her desire to instill fear in criminals. I also like that we get a nod to her comic outfit through the purple ropes and yellow bands of the crime scenes that she sets up. Wraith is a really badass character, and I'm very excited to see her return in future games. Having her and Peter somewhat at odds will make for some great tension, and it's an interaction in the sequel that I'm really excited to see. Next, we'll stick with the DLC side missions and discuss another great mission, this time during DLC 1. While swinging, we'll get a call from a police officer named Detective Mackey, who requests we meet him in person. When we meet the detective, he asks for our help in solving an unsolved crime from 20 years ago. The crime involved the original Black Cat, Walter Hardy, Felicia's father. Mackey states that Walter died in prison, but his stolen artwork is still missing, but he thinks he has a lead on it. He states that the police department doesn't want to waste the resources on solving it, so he's reaching out to Spider-Man instead. Mackey's lead is an idea he got from watching a movie where a thief used radioactive isotopes to tag his stolen goods so he could find them at a later point after hiding them. This theory is proven true, and Spider-Man is able to track down the first piece of art hidden in a fake power box. We'll then continue to track down all of the missing artwork for the detective, and he'll tell us more about Walter Hardy, like how he died during an escape attempt from Riker's prison. He also tells Spider-Man that he doesn't think the new Black Cat is Felicia Hardy, and that he's already looked into it. He also asks Spider-Man about what the new Black Cat is like.
She's manipulative, but she's also got a good heart. She only robs folks who can afford it, or who she thinks deserve it.
And she gave you the slip, huh?
More than once. I can honestly say I've never met anyone quite like her.
I know the feeling.
In another conversation, they discuss how the new Black Cat compares to the old one.
So in your professional opinion, is the new cat similar to the old one?
Well, she's clearly modeling herself after Hardy. Her style, technique. Hell, her grapple looks like an updated version of his old tech.
Right. You guys had her equipment in lockup for a while. So she steals intellectual property, too.
More like improves on it. She's elevated Hardy's work to a whole new level.
Almost sounds like you admire her.
Do this long enough, you can't help noticing real talent.
And I just want to play one more conversation between them for when you find the final painting.
That's the last piece of Hardy's legacy. I really can't thank you enough, Spider-Man.
Glad to help, Detective Mackey.
And hey, I think you're right about the new cat. Look out for her, okay? It'd mean a lot to me.
That was weird. What did he mean by that?
I wanted to play a few of these clips because they take on a really cool double meaning when you learn the truth behind this side mission. Shortly after this last conversation, Spider-Man will try to call him back and find that the number has been disabled. So he heads back to the precinct and asks a cop for Detective Mackey. The cop tells him that no one by that name works there, and Spider-Man realizes that he's been conned. Detective Mackey was Walter Hardy all along, and he duped Spider-Man into retrieving all his stolen artwork for him. His real story was that he was an accomplished thief who caught the attention of the Magia. They wanted to hire him and he refused, so they threatened his family. Walter turned himself in to buy some time, but ultimately faked his own death so the Magia would stop hunting him, but more importantly, Felicia would be safe. Still, he thinks it's best that Felicia never know he's alive, so he's taking his artwork and leaving town. It's a bit of a sad story, but it's fun to see how similar Felicia is to her father. Conning runs in the family, and I'll be honest, he tricked me too. I didn't suspect that Mackey was actually Walter Hardy, and I thought that was a fun twist. It's also interesting because Walter Hardy is legit dead in the comics. In those comics, he was locked up in prison and terminally ill. Felicia managed to break him out of his prison and bring him home. There, she reveals to him that she's the new Black Cat and that she knows he's her father. Felicia's mother then arrives, and Felicia leaves to give her and Walter some time together. Later, we see that Walter died from his illness in the arms of his wife, and that's the last we see of him. So I thought it was a good trick that he faked his death in the game's universe. I also thought it was a lot of fun re-listening to the conversations Walter has with Spider-Man during this quest. The first time through, they legitimately felt like normal conversations between Spider-Man and a detective. On second listen, you can tell he knows more than he's letting on, or that he's prying for details, like wanting to know what Felicia is like now, or showing admiration in her skills as the new Black Cat. It's kind of sweet, and you can tell he's a caring father, despite being a thief and a con man. So I like this side mission a lot, and it's a fun one to replay. Next, I want to go back to the main game and discuss some of those side missions. We'll first start with Taskmaster. His side mission begins when you find a strange box on top of a building. Taskmaster leaves you a message telling you that there are bombs set to go off in the city and that you need to rush and go disarm them. You'll do as he says and disarm them as quickly as you can. He set up multiple of these recon points around the city though, so we'll work to complete each of his challenges. Afterwards, he'll often call in for a minor chat or critique.
You're pulling your punches.
I'm fine just stopping criminals. I don't need to kill them.
You never hold back. I won't.
This guy's got issues.
He's right though, Spider-Man does pull his punches. When Otto Octavius took over Peter's body as the superior Spider-Man, he learned this the hard way by punching the Scorpion full force, accidentally knocking his jaw clean off. At that moment, he realized that Peter had been pulling his punches in most fights. We should also discuss Taskmaster from the comics a bit too. His name is Anthony Masters, and at one point was an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. However, he eventually took on more lucrative contracts as a mercenary due to his unique superpowers. Those abilities are photographic reflexes, which means that whenever he witnesses someone perform a movement, he can instantly replicate it himself. This makes him a master martial artist and a formidable foe to go up against. A great comic example is a time when Taskmaster fought Captain America one-on-one. During the fight, Captain America was able to narrate the moves and the associated fighters Taskmaster was using against him. In this case, Swordsman, Iron Fist, and even his own moves. So in the game, it makes sense why Taskmaster has set up these different challenges for us, because he wants to watch us in action so he can copy our moves. One incredible detail that Insomniac included is having Taskmaster physically in the area during these missions, although he can be really hard to spot at times. To start, he's most visible during the combat challenges during the daytime. He'll typically be somewhere up high, watching you with binoculars. If he's within the mission perimeter, you can usually get pretty close to him, although if you get too close, he'll disappear in a cloud of smoke. I even attempted to use gadgets on him from afar, but when you aim at him, your attack will be disabled. However, I did manage to get him to react a bit to the concussive blast when aimed off to the side of him. He'll flinch at it a bit, but that's about all. I believe you can find him in all the other challenges too, but he can be really tough to spot. For example, in the nighttime stealth missions, he's really tough to see since he's so far away. You can barely see him here with his binoculars. This is about as close as you can get to him too, since he's placed outside the mission perimeter. Here's another stealth mission example, and you can just barely see him off in the distance on that rooftop. Again, he's outside of the mission boundaries, so this was about as close as I could get to him. So the combat missions are definitely your best bet if you want to get close to him, since he's placed within the mission and somewhat easily visible. Regardless, it's a lot of fun trying to find him in each mission, and equally as fun trying to get close to him. It's so cool that Insomniac chose to hide him in these missions in the first place too. It's really in character that he'd be watching you from moment to moment, and it's a fun Easter egg that's extremely easy to miss. But after we complete a few of his challenges, Taskmaster will feel confident that he's learned enough from us and will want to test himself. So while we're just swinging through the city, he'll subdue us out of nowhere so we can fight on a rooftop. The surprise of this fight is really awesome by itself, but I also love how he'll legitimately use some of our moves against us. For example, he'll slide underneath us and then kick us twice in the back. This is the same move that we'll often pull on S.H.I.E.L.D. enemies. Another example is the spin kick that he'll perform on us. I recognize this move from one of our takedowns. He may not be able to replicate our webs, but he attempts similar moves using his grappling hook, which I thought was a fun detail. So even if he can't replicate specific powers, he'll try to get as close as he can using his available tech. I had a lot of fun with this fight, and it's really cool spotting the moves he's learned from us as he uses them against us. He'll eventually flee from the fight though, determining that he still has more to learn from us, pushing us to continue his challenges. We don't have much of a choice since innocent lives are at risk, so we continue forward. After completing the rest of his challenges, he'll confront you for another duel. During this fight, he started using my own takedowns against me, which I thought was another cool touch because it felt like he was further mastering my abilities. I also learned that the fight doesn't have to remain on the rooftop where it began, as you can take the fight down to the street and Taskmaster will follow you around. This detail enhanced the fight for me, since it made it feel more like a legit city brawl, and added to the immersion since we weren't running up against invisible walls. Plus, I think this was the only time I was able to fight a boss in the city streets among civilians, so it was fun seeing them react and run away. But with Taskmaster defeated, Spider-Man starts asking what the point of all this was.
Why are you stalking me?
An organization hired me to see if you're worth recruiting.
I'd rather be Jonah Jameson's foot masseur than work for anyone who'd hire you.
Your loss? They pay six figures. Guess some people just deserve to be poor.
Six figures?
Who hired Taskmaster is still a prevailing mystery within this game. What he said was about as much as we know. They're rich, they've hired Taskmaster, and they were debating on recruiting Spider-Man. I debated on going deep into speculation on who this organization may be, but honestly, I don't have a clear answer for it. There are a bunch of possibilities, like the Thunderbolts or even AIM, and for all I know, Insomniac could be going their own original direction. At the time of this recording, it hasn't been addressed in Spider-Man 2, but there's still hope for some kind of DLC that could shed some light on Taskmaster's employer. So I think we'll have to wait things out for now, but as it stands, I'm very curious to learn more about this dangling plot thread, and I think it's really cool that Insomniac are planning ahead like this, leaving hints in the first game that will pay off in the future. Continuing on to another great villain side mission though, let's talk about Tombstone. We got a glimpse of him during an MJ mission in the main game, where she found some of his shipment trackers and passed them on to Peter. Spider-Man's investigation leads him to the Alchemax chemical facility, where he finds Tombstone's men attempting to load a chemical called Diox-3. Just then, more of Tombstone's men show up, and one of them uses an inhaler which turns his skin pale white and gives it a rocky texture. The rest of the gang has access to the substance as well, and it significantly boosts their durability, allowing them to easily shake off our hits. It's only temporary though, and soon after, they'll return to their normal, vulnerable state. What they're taking is Tombstone's new drug, which he calls Grave Dust. It essentially gives the user his abilities temporarily, and he soon plans to sell it on the streets. Before getting too far, let's talk about Tombstone in the comics. In the beginning, he wasn't superpowered at all. Instead, he was a normal child named Lonnie Lincoln, who was diagnosed with albinism, which is why he has pale skin. He was made fun of at school for this, but eventually started to fight back. He even decided to take on a more striking image, filing his teeth to a point. In the game, we can see he maintains this feature as well. In the comics though, as he grew older, he became accustomed to intimidating and bullying the other students. However, fellow classmate Robbie Robertson planned to write an expose on him for the school paper. Robbie Robertson, as you might recall, is the current editor-in-chief of the Daily Bugle newspaper and MJ's boss, so he's been a journalist since a young age. Back then, Lonnie learned of Robbie's plan and beat him up until he agreed to drop the story, which Robbie ultimately did, something he still regrets into adulthood. 8 years later, Robbie was working for a newspaper in Philadelphia and received a tip from a caller who claimed he witnessed a murder. Robbie knew exposing the killer could be big for his career, so he rushed out to meet the tipster in person. By the time he arrived, Lonnie already got there first and killed the tipster, flaunting the body in front of Robbie. Robbie fled in terror and ended up moving to New York to work at the Bugle. Still, his past with Tombstone haunted him and he followed his criminal career. Tombstone murdered a lot of people over the years and always got away with it. Eventually, Tombstone made his way to New York as well, and Robbie felt a responsibility to finally put an end to it, so he met Tombstone in the park with the intention of shooting him. Tombstone wore a bulletproof vest though, and to teach Robbie a lesson, he broke his back. Over time, and with some physical therapy, Robbie was able to walk again, but Tombstone still haunted him. They would later meet again at a chemical plant where Tombstone aimed to steal the chemical Diox-3. Robbie had him at gunpoint again, and when Tombstone charged him, Robbie shot him, and Tombstone fell into the chemical chamber and was exposed to the gas. When the door to the chamber was opened, Tombstone was gone. Later, Tombstone re-emerged, and we learned that the chemical made him indestructible and even more formidable than before. So that's the origin for Tombstone, and I like how closely it ties with Robbie Robertson. Going back to the game, Tombstone is clearly an intimidating foe, especially due to his powers, so it's clear that his new drug could be a huge problem if it hits the streets. Thankfully, Peter is quickly able to whip together a counter drug to nullify the effects. With this new counter drug, Spider-Man decides to pay Tombstone a visit at his chop shop. By the way, on the sign above Tombstone's shop, in the bottom left corner is written WOSM36-SSM139. These reference two big comics for Tombstone. The first half is an abbreviation for Web of Spider-Man issue 36, Tombstone's first appearance. The second half is Tombstone's big cover issue featuring his origin, which is Spectacular Spider-Man issue 139. When we enter the shop, we find Tombstone drinking.
The angry drug lord drank alone. There's a poem in there somewhere.
You know better than me.
never was the literary type.
That's all the conversating we'll get as Tombstone gets right to business. We immediately begin the fight, and Tombstone's a really intimidating boss with his size and strength, and that sledgehammer looks like it could hurt a lot. We'll spend the early parts of this fight dodging and attacking Tombstone as needed, but Spider-Man realizes hitting him isn't doing much good, thanks to Tombstone's durability. He'll need to expose him to the counter drug, but first, more of Tombstone's men show up to lend him a hand. We have to clear out all of his men first before we can attempt to gas Tombstone. After clearing them out, we'll get our chance, and we'll quickly see the results when a saw blade falls off a shelf and cuts Tombstone. He knows he's normal again, and I love the shift in atmosphere as he realizes this, as the shop begins to catch on fire. Lonnie may be human again, but he's not done yet, and grabs a flaming chain from the ground to attack us with. This fight gets even more intense, and it's almost like fighting Ghost Rider. Even as a normal guy, Tombstone is incredibly strong and still a major threat. I also love his fighting spirit, since even when weakened, he's still enjoying the thrill of the fight.
End of the day, this is what I love. Great fight, great challenge.
You and I are very different people.
After damaging him enough, Tombstone collapses to the ground. He's not used to being injured, so the fight is over, despite his wishes. Still, he only sees this as a minor setback and has no future plans of slowing down.
Too much to hope you'll be taking it easier now that you're, mortal?
Not a chance. Threat of death just ups the thrill. Hell of a left hook. Can't wait for the rematch.
I can't wait either. Tombstone is a badass dude and a really fun fight. I kind of hope he gets his powers back too, so we can fight him at full strength again. But I have to imagine we'll see Tombstone again in the future, especially with him already talking about a round two. It'd also be interesting to see him interact with Robbie in the future as well, given how much history they have in the comics. We could even see Tombstone's daughter in a later game, since she's referenced in a Daily Bugle newspaper after this mission. In the bottom left it says, Janice Lincoln defends father. In the comics, Janice takes up the mantle of the villain Beetle and follows in her father's criminal footsteps. Funnily enough, Janice also ends up in a serious relationship with Randy Robertson, Robbie's son, so Robbie can't catch a break in trying to distance himself from Lonnie. Although Tombstone's not too happy about it either. Continuing on and sticking with these supervillain side missions, let's talk about the most hated one amongst fans, Screwball. This mission begins when we meet a civilian on a roof asking if we'll do the Screwball Challenge. At this time, we have no idea what that is, but she tells us doing it will help the needy. All we have to do is take a picture of the QR code on the wall, and doing so immediately prompts a phone call from the character Screwball, who tells us that we're now part of her stream and what we need to do.
This is starting to sound time-consuming. Sorry, but people need my help.
Ooh, funny you should say that, because this is to help the needy. One in particular. The final Matrix barcode will give you the location of a... Wait for it. Kidnapping victim.
What?
I know! Talk about raising the stakes!
So this side mission starts pretty funny and goofy, and honestly, I'm game for it in these early moments. However, I think we'll see that it eventually overstays its welcome. But for now, we start snapping shots of the QR codes around the city in hopes of freeing the captured citizen. Eventually, we'll snap enough of them to get the location we need, and we break in to save the hostage.
Oh my god, Spider-Man! I can't thank you enough! For the millions of clicks I just got!
Wow!
Screwball!
Ha! I know, right? Ah, you should see the look on your... creepy moving eyehole thingies. Oh, look! More of my followers!
I think that cutscene gives you a good sense of Screwball's personality. The whole point is that she's an annoying and cringy streamer, and to a degree, I think it can be pretty funny at times.
Thug Forever says, love you, Screwball! Your stream kept me going while I was in jail.
Although at other times, I think Insomniac do a little too good at making Screwball annoying. She can become sort of grating at times, but I think in small doses it's not too bad. And in this side mission, she's really not a problem. In fact, this mission ends pretty quickly with her in handcuffs being taken into custody by the police. However, she's already making the point that she didn't personally commit any crimes and that all the crimes were committed by her fans. So as you'd expect, the charges don't stick and she appears in DLC 1. This time, she set up a series of challenges around the city for us, and we'll get scored based on our performance. Spider-Man has no choice but to comply, since Screwball has innocent lives at risk to motivate him.
Some people do anything for clicks.
Each of Screwball's challenges have unique custom mechanics applied to them as well. For example, a photobomb moment, and when you trigger one, time will slow down and you have to time a button press to apply bonus points to your final score. I thought these were pretty cool, and lead to some cinematic moments during the slow-mo. Her combat challenges have a photobomb option too, if you can KO an enemy in the spotlight at the right time. These were satisfying to pull off, and the zoom-ins at the end were often pretty funny. I also like the gadget challenges, where you're restricted to using only two of your gadgets, and you have to combo them together. I think this was a good tutorial type of challenge to get the player mixing different gadgets together that they may not be otherwise utilizing together. So I enjoyed the majority of these challenges for the most part. That's not to say it's all great, and I think there are some key reasons why fans seem to hate these screwball missions so much. To start, the difficulty could be part of it. Some of the high scores can be tough to obtain even after multiple tries, and it's even more annoying due to Screwball's taunts at the end.
I'd give that performance a B. Minus. Minus.
So if you're a completionist, things can get a bit frustrating. Not only that, but these missions can start to feel repetitive due to there being Screwball missions in all three DLCs, not counting her side mission in the first game. I think if she was isolated to just one of the DLCs, it wouldn't be too bad. Instead, I think she overstays her welcome, and her missions and personality begin to wear on you. That being said, I know Screwball is intentionally meant to be annoying and kind of a dig at influencers, and probably people like me, which honestly, it is pretty funny to make fun of influencer culture, but like I said, I think Insomniac do a little too good at it. Still, I like Screwball as an outlet for them to make these kind of jokes. For example, I think Insomniac also include a fun meta joke during one of her calls after you successfully 3-star a challenge.
Awesome! When Spidey does well, I do well! That's called Simbi! Whatever. Don't forget to click the like button!
I think the word she was about to say was symbiosis, so the joke is likely Insomniac's awareness of that word's association with Venom's symbiote and how hungry fans are for that character, to the point Insomniac feel like they have to avoid certain keywords that fans might unnecessarily make a big deal out of. So like, Screwball said symbiosis, Venom confirmed, those type of headlines. So I think that's the tongue-in-cheek joke here, or at least that was my interpretation of it. We actually did get Venom in Spider-Man 2, so for all I know, this could have been a legit tease for him. Regardless, it's satisfying when you finally complete all of her missions and you're ready to take her down for good. After completing all of her challenges, Screwball will have a rap party on a rooftop in the city. Spider-Man knows she's a narcissist who couldn't refuse missing her own party, so he banks on the idea that she'll be there somewhere. He's right, but Screwball actually intended on him showing up, and she wants this chase to be her series finale. So we chase Screwball through the city, stopping to disarm her traps and perform photobombs along the way as well. It's actually a pretty tough, fast-paced challenge, so it works as a fitting finale of her challenge series. I also like how it mirrors the comics. In the comics, Screwball isn't superpowered, she's just a master at parkour. This allows her to swiftly navigate the city, and even outrun Spider-Man despite his super agility. So that's why she's so fast in the game. Screwball is also a live-streaming villain in the comics, and like in the game, she's broadcasted out to Spider-Man before to try to get him on stream after noticing that her views increase 85% whenever he shows up. So the game and comic iterations of Screwball are pretty similar for the most part. In the game, we'll finally catch up to her and tie her up for the police. Her DLC series ends with her being placed in a police car, and it's a relief to know it's finally over. But that was the last of these side missions featuring a comic villain. If I had one criticism for these side missions in the game, it's that I'd like to see more notable villains in the world. Similar to something like Batman Arkham Knight, which featured a scroll wheel dedicated to keeping track of all the villains you need to apprehend in the city. Maybe that game just spoiled me, but I'd like to see Insomniac include more villains in a similar fashion. However, Brian Inahar stated in an interview with Beyond that he recalls at least 4 villains being cut due to time.
I think there's about 4 others that we were talking about that, you know, just, you know, you start, you know, looking at the game, you're like, we got to get this thing done. And
it was, right.
No. And like, I don't think they got beyond maybe concept phase, and it was just too much.
Brian never goes on to state who these characters were specifically, but I think there's enough evidence around now for me to speculate on it. 2 in particular have been found by data miners, namely Tiffsomniac on YouTube. Tiff was able to find an old texture file in the game showing Spider-Man in front of Feast across from the villain, the Hood, on the left. In the comics, Parker Robbins is a criminal who comes into possession of a demonic cloak and boots that give him mystical powers. He uses these abilities to create his own criminal enterprise, and has also butt heads against Mr. Negative through their own turf wars. That last bit in particular leads me to believe that the Hood could have been a cut character if he was meant to be at odds with both Spider-Man and Martin Lee. The Hood has also been used in the Spider-Man 2 prequel comic, so we know at least he exists in this universe. Tiffsomniac, as well as Redditor CoreyReynolds, also found game models for comic villains named Crime Master and Big Man. Crime Master actually has a legit character model in the game files. However, this model is also used for Big Man, likely meaning Big Man didn't get too far into development. Crime Master and Big Man make sense as cut characters as well if Insomniac were going for a Turf Wars theme in the main game at one point. Big Man led a group called the Enforcers who helped him to attempt to take over the criminal underworld. Crime Master is kind of similar in the sense that he's a thug with grand ambitions. There have been multiple people to wear the mantle of both Crime Master and Big Man, so it's tough to pin down where exactly Insomniac might have taken these characters. For example, Crime Master and Big Man teamed up in the comics once, later resulting in Crime Master shooting Big Man. It was then revealed that these weren't the original Crime Master and Big Man, but instead, Crime Master's son and Big Man's daughter, who both had the same idea to dress up as their parents' criminal identities for revenge. The original Big Man's son also decided to take up the mantle, piloting a giant mechanical Big Man suit. That would actually be pretty awesome to see in the game. There's also a comic where Mr. Negative uses one of his inner demons to impersonate the latest Crime Master and lead the Enforcers. So Crime Master could have been used as a mole in the Enforcers group under Big Man, but I'm just loosely speculating at this point. Regardless, I could see some kind of turf war theme between these cut characters. So those could be three of the four cut characters that Brian was referring to. If that's the case, I hope Insomniac choose to recycle them into the sequel in some way. Outside of the villains, there are still plenty of side missions to complete in the game. I won't get into each of them since they're pretty standard side missions, but they're unique enough in their own right to be enjoyable. For example, stopping crimes with the assistance of a bird watcher who acts as our lookout, or helping a man named Howard by returning his lost pigeons. One in particular that I really liked was following the trail of an imposter Spider-Man. It seems Spider-Man has inspired a copycat who's dressing up like him and stopping crimes. When you eventually track him down, it's just some guy who knows martial arts, helping the city the best he can. He gets in over his head though when he's faced with enemies wielding guns. Thankfully, we're there just in time to help out, and it's pretty fun fighting alongside this guy. We also get some fun references during this mission. For example, while we're fighting, he mentions being a martial arts instructor at the Chikara Dojo. The Chikara Dojo is from the Iron Fist Netflix show, owned by Iron Fist but operated by Colleen Wing. So it's nice seeing that show referenced and getting some love, since it usually just gets hate. This isn't the only Iron Fist, or really Defenders, reference in the game, as we'll see more nods to him and the rest of the team a bit later. This mission also contains a couple Spider-Man villain references. For example, here's this one.
Still alive. So whoever did this isn't a lethal protector. That's promising.
This is a reference to the villain Venom, who's known as the Lethal Protector in the comics. There's also this mention of Chameleon.
Someone's impersonating me. It could be the Chameleon again. I've got to pick up his trail.
Chameleon is a master of disguise and the first villain Spider-Man faced in the comics, so it's cool to see him mentioned here and confirm that Spider-Man has encountered him previously in the game's lore as well. Before this mission ends, we get one other fun Spider-Man comic reference.
Your heart's in the right place, but if you keep this up, you're gonna get killed.
Yeah, I see that now. Don't worry, I'm hanging up the suit. Spider-Man No More.
Good call.
Spider-Man No More is a reference to the famous comic where Peter decides to quit being Spider-Man and throw away his suit, so a fun little nod there. Another mission, or series of missions, I found unique were the ones with ESU student Philip Chang, who requests our help in finding missing ESU students from the Halloween party. Philip uses his own facial recognition software to give us a last known location, and it's up to us to use the picture to try and find its exact location in the city. As someone who has never been to New York personally, I found these to be fun little missions to help me get accustomed to the different areas instead of just always relying on the Spider GPS. Plus, I felt like the game gave me just the right amount of hints to get me in the general area, which I appreciated. Each of these missions will also result in us finding leftover corrupted students from the Halloween party, and we have to web them up. I like the Halloween mission a lot, so I'm enjoying this extension to it. There are some cool comic references in this side mission series too. For example, one of the people you're meant to find is Brad Davis, the quarterback for the ESU college football team. Brad Davis is from the comics and is also the school's quarterback. In his first comic appearance, he was even dating MJ. Brad was also used in the Spider-Man Far From Home movie as the guy who was competing for MJ's attention. You'll also rescue Steve Hopkins, another character from the comics. In the comics, he's another ESU student with Peter. Philip himself is also from the comics, and his story was that he originally lived in Hong Kong and was a troubled youth. This meant he had enemies, and one day a grenade was thrown into his home. Philip was able to evade it, but his parents were killed in the blast. At that moment, he decided to renounce his violent ways and move to America to start a new life. There, he was also a student at ESU and was touted as one of their greatest minds. In later comics, Peter owns his own company called Parker Industries and hired Philip as chief of the Renewable Energy Research Department. In the game, Philip is very tech-savvy and hopes to land a job through his facial recognition software, and Spider-Man even offers to be a reference for him. Philip later accomplishes his goal as we see through his social media posts where he gets hired by Roxxon. We'll talk about Roxxon a lot more when we get to the Miles Morales spin-off game. Going back to the social media feed, Philip has a pretty fun presence in there as well. Not only does he post updates regarding his work at Roxxon, but he also creates an AI called Changbot that posts for him every day. However, it often bugs out and acts in ways he doesn't anticipate. For example, one of its posts is a factoid that AI will likely become sentient by the year 2073 and enslave humanity. It even adds, hashtag can't wait, much to the horror of Philip. Brad Davis, the quarterback we saved earlier, also has a consistent social media presence. Most of the time, it's about the success of the ESU football team. However, he also makes a couple thirst posts. For example, one is about Black Cat when he learns that she isn't dead. Another regards Silver Sable and how Brad thinks she's kinda hot. His girlfriend actually reacts to this post and breaks up with him in the comments. I guess while we're on the subject of the social media feed, we might as well discuss some other cool details within it. For example, it's not just Brad posting thirst tweets. Another user named West Coast Poe also makes one about Black Cat, but his girlfriend finds the post and they argue in the comments. Another one that I thought was funny was a message chain between some bros about who can bench as much as Spider-Man. The usernames in this chain consist of things like Brocidon, Brometheus, and Marco Brolo. Spider-Man actually responds to them with encouragement, and it's cool that Spider-Man posts in here as well. You can actually find an exchange between Peter and Aunt May in the social media feed as well, after her 5-year anniversary at Feast. In it, Peter tells May that she needs to turn off caps lock for any future posts that she makes. I also thought it was really cool that you can find posts from the user JJ in space. This is actually J. Jonah Jameson's son, John Jameson, who's an astronaut. John is actually the first person saved by Spider-Man in the comics. In Amazing Spider-Man number 1, he saved John's flight capsule from crash landing. Of course, instead of being grateful of his son's savior, Jonah instead began bashing Spider-Man in the papers, claiming that Spider-Man sabotaged the ship in the first place. Funnily enough, there's also a really cool what-if comic about what would happen if it was John Jameson who became Spider-Man instead of Peter. Hypocritically, Jonah is actually really supportive of Spider-Man when it's his son. Jonah even designs his suit. In this comic, John tries to save a runaway flight capsule like in the original comics, but dies in the process. More canonically though, John Jameson later becomes the creature Man-Wolf. As far as in the game though, John seems to be in space the whole time, but keeps up the news back home and comments about it on the feed. For example, expressing happiness when Martin Lee was caught. He'll also post about his dad's podcast, which he listens to in space. Jonah will occasionally comment on these posts as well, and his username is JJJ at home, a fun pairing with his son's username. You can find Mary Jane's username as well, and it's another one that I found interesting. Hers is MJ Watson Jackpot. This is a reference to a famous line of hers in the comics. For some context, Aunt May had been trying to set Peter up on a blind date with MJ for a while, but he kept brushing it off, thinking she would be ugly. For example, this panel where he says, "I'm as anxious to meet Mary Jane Watson as I am to meet the Hulk, and she'll probably look just like him." Eventually, Aunt May gets Peter to meet MJ, and her first line to him is, "Face it, Tiger, you just hit the jackpot." So that's why the word jackpot is part of her username. I also find it interesting because MJ has recently become a hero named Jackpot in the comics. So who knows, maybe the game will eventually follow suit. I also thought it was cool that you can find posts from Gloria at Feast. Her username is SoyGloria, and she'll post updates about her time there. For example, she mentions that Aunt May makes incredible wheat cakes. I thought that one in particular was fun because Spider-Man's recommendation of wheat cakes at Feast was what convinced her to go in the first place.
"Just in case, there's a place called the Feast Center."
"Seen it. I don't want charity."
"They got the best wheat cakes in the city, hands down."
"Mom used to make those. Haven't had any in a long time."
Insomniac CEO Ted Price even makes a post, and it's the biggest troll of all. It reads, "Hey, did you hear that Insomniac Games is announcing a new game next week?" That post has been there ever since this game released back in 2018, and it looks like something that would be snuck into the game right before a big reveal, but it's not. It's just a troll that fakes out new players. It's not exactly a lie either though, since occasionally that post will be correct whenever they randomly reveal new games. One of those, even a broken clock is right twice a day sort of things. Going back to the social media feed, there's a lot more that you can find within these social posts, but these were the ones that stood out to me most. A lot of other characters you interact with in the game can be found making posts, and I thought this was a cool inclusion to make the city feel more lively and real. Besides side missions, there are still tons of things to do in the open world. Random crimes alone do a good job of making the city feel lively, and I often found myself detouring from main objectives to complete them. I like that Insomniac aimed to provide variety to the different crimes you might encounter, and I think of the Spider-Man games I've played for this channel, the random crimes are done best here. Still, due to the sheer volume of random crimes across the main game and DLC, they do eventually start to feel a bit repetitive. I think that's just the nature with random crimes, but it's something I'd like to see Insomniac attempt to remedy in future games. Still, I appreciate how much effort went into providing as much variety as possible into them, and I think there's a great foundation to build on here, so it's definitely something I'd like to see return. Another open world feature I'd like to see return are criminal hideouts, which were one of my favorite inclusions. Each of the enemy groups has their own hideouts and bases, and you can sneak in to fight waves of them. I thought these were a great way to lean into the combat mechanics of the game and let the player really dig in and unleash their skills. These became fun areas for me to try out all of my gadgets, as well as test out the different suit powers that I unlocked. More on those in a bit. I think the hideouts were also good proving grounds against the different enemy types, so I found them to be both fun and beneficial. I wasn't quite as into the next side challenge series though, which are research stations. They're scattered around the city and are a passion project of Harry Osborne. Harry is picking up where his mother left off since she first began this environmental research, such as researching a safe way to dissolve plastics. Sadly, she died before she could fully see it through. Harry admires his mother and wants to follow in her footsteps, so he commissioned these research stations to continue her work. They don't seem to be a priority for Oscorp though, as Spider-Man often voices concern that these stations will be shut down if they're not shown to be producing results. So while Harry's away, we do the work for him. Things like swinging through smoke clouds to analyze the cause of pollutants, or fixing the water pressure in the city's pipes, or managing data flow by repositioning transmission dishes. Each one feels unique from the other, but in general, they felt kind of tedious to me. That's not to say they're all bad and I enjoyed some of them, but completing these felt the most like a grind compared to the other city activities. After completing them though, MJ will give you a call to tell you that Oscorp deemed the stations as providing valuable data, so they'll fully fund them. So finally a win for Harry, even if he doesn't know it yet. Leaning into Peter's background as a photographer, you're also tasked with taking snapshots of landmarks around the city. This one is probably somewhat tedious for other players, but I kind of enjoyed this one. Like I mentioned, I've never been to New York, so I felt like a pseudo-tourist getting to check out these landmarks via the game. Although, it's probably no surprise that my favorite part was finding the Marvel locations and hearing Peter comment on some of them. For example, the Wakandan Embassy.
I wonder if King T'Challa got his powers from being bitten by a radioactive panther. Dude's tough, but that'd still probably hurt.
As I'm sure you're aware, Black Panther gets his powers from the heart-shaped herb in Wakanda, not from a radioactive panther bite. There's also the Simkarian Embassy, frequented by Silver Sable. We can also get a shot of the Sanctum Sanctorum, home to Doctor Strange.
Cool window, but I always get the feeling something strange is going on in that place.
This is also where those Defenders Easter eggs come into play, the first of which is Fogwell's Gym. Fogwell's Gym is where Matt Murdock's father used to train as a boxer. Occasionally, Matt will train here as well, as you can see on this comic page. So all the FAP sound effects written on the page are boxing sounds, I just want to reinforce that. I was actually reading some Daredevil comics recently and I noticed they've since reversed it to now read PAF every time someone hits a punching bag, which I thought was funny. There's also Josie's Bar, a location frequented by Daredevil in the Netflix series, but it's also a location from the comics. We can also find the apartment building containing Alias Investigations, the private investigation company owned by Jessica Jones. Unfortunately, if you're playing on the Remastered Edition, there's a bug where instead of Alias Investigations, it'll say Homeless Need Help, which almost seems relevant to Jessica, but it's just an incorrect asset and nothing lore related. We can also find the Rand Corporation owned by Danny Rand, aka Iron Fist. Sadly, there weren't any Luke Cage Easter eggs, at least not that I could find. Another Marvel location we can find is Damage Control, and they're the construction company tasked with repairing damage from superhero fights. Lastly, and most importantly, Avengers Tower. When you take a picture of it, Peter says this.
Avengers Tower is so cool, but they're never around to use it. I think they're probably somewhere on the West Coast right now. Probably surfing or something.
Or at least he should say that, even on the Remastered Edition. There were some rumors it was cut for the remaster, but that's not the case. It's just difficult to get Peter to say it without first being interrupted by either phone calls or nearby conversations. The Avengers being in the West Coast is interesting though. This sparked a lot of fans to believe it was a nod to the Marvel's Avengers game, where the Avengers began on the West Coast. This has since been proven false, at least officially, and mostly serves as a reason why the Avengers aren't in the area to deal with the Devil's Breath outbreak. Still, Insomniac had discussed putting more Easter eggs in Avengers Tower initially, but ultimately decided against it, as described by Brian Inahar in this interview with Beyond.
False expectations about what the game was. Like, so Avengers Tower, right? You know, we debated, like, well, can people look into it? And can people, like, see Tony walking around? And I'm like, here's what happens. If we do that, people want a mission with Tony Stark.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then they want to see Iron Man. And then they want to maybe play as Iron Man. And I'm like, our job is to make the best Spider-Man game ever. Like, that's our job. Like, we want to give the ultimate Spider-Man experience. Anything that detracts from that is going to be bad.
As cool as that would have been, he's absolutely right. If we saw Tony Stark even for a second, it would overshadow everything and we'd be clamoring for an Iron Man game. Outside of the main landmark hunt is also a secret photo op. Thankfully, you can buy an upgrade that shows you when you're close to one, so this isn't a complete grind. A lot of what you'll find in these secret photo ops are creative artworks around the city, like a crying Jameson, or a pest control building with Scorpion on it. There are more really artistic examples, but I'm mostly going to call out the different Easter eggs. First up is this statue of the Marvel comic character Lockjaw. This is cool and probably seems random, but there's actually a story behind it. Apparently, Insomniac were struggling against legal teams not letting them use the Wall Street Bull statue, so instead they decided to use a bulldog. Marvel loved the idea and used Lockjaw in its place. Lockjaw in the comics is an inhuman with the ability to teleport, so I'm not sure that there's a lore reason behind his statue being here yet, but it's really awesome nonetheless. You can also find the law office of Nelson and Murdoch. Matt Murdoch is lawyer by day, daredevil by night, and he runs his legal practice alongside his best friend Foggy Nelson. That red notice on the door is a bit troubling though, so maybe business isn't booming. Another secret photo op that I thought was cool was this one for Norman's campaign office. There isn't much else to it, but I thought it was kind of fun to walk around and you can see people working inside the building. This last one is sort of bittersweet, and that's the gravesite of Aunt May and Uncle Ben. Earlier in the game, it's just Ben's grave, but after you complete the main game, you can revisit it to find that Aunt May was buried next to him. So as sad as it is that they're gone, it's sweet that they're buried together. If you return back to Feast after beating the game too, you can also find a plaque in honor of Aunt May inside. There are also some notable landmarks that aren't part of the photo hunt, one of which is a fun little Easter egg to the Ghostbusters movie. If you find the firehouse that serves as their headquarters in the film, there's a ghost painted on one of the walls. This last landmark isn't quite as fun, since it's been deemed the saddest Easter egg ever. Prior to the game's release, Spider-Man fan Tyler Schultz tweeted Insomniac for help in proposing to his girlfriend, Maddie. Insomniac actually agreed and asked if he could wait until September 7th, when the game would release. Tyler said, "We've just passed our 5 years in April, so I think she'll still be around." When the game released, Insomniac put the words, "Maddie, will you marry me?" on a theater marquee in the game's city. Sadly, Schultz later updated everyone stating that 3 to 4 weeks before the game released, she broke up with him. He also mentioned that this wasn't how she wanted to be proposed to anyway. He was right, since Maddie later gave her own statement on the matter, stating that she wasn't into video games and really just sat through them for Schultz. The proposal has since been patched out of the game, but you can still find images of it online, and I'll have the Polygon article about it in the description below. But yeah, the story is pretty sad, and I feel bad for both Maddie and Tyler, but it's at least really cool that Insomniac were willing to assist in the proposal in the first place. On a happier note, within the open world are also old backpacks that Peter left scattered around the city. Peter had pretty much forgotten about these, and each one contains some kind of memento from his past. As you can imagine, I love these, because each one adds to the lore of the universe and provides some fun comic references. To start, if you're wondering why Peter has so many backpacks, he mentions winning a lifetime supply of them through the Wilson Fisk Science Prize. One of the backpacks contains a Work-Life Balance for Idiots book written by Dr. Ludwig Reinhardt. The author is the Easter egg, and in the comics is a fake identity created by Quentin Beck, aka Mysterio. Mysterio used his tech to make Spider-Man think he was going crazy, and then positioned himself as Dr. Ludwig Reinhardt so Spider-Man would seek him out for therapy. Mysterio's end goal was to learn Spider-Man's secret identity through one of these sessions. I also thought it was fun that we can find a couple of Aunt May's recipes, one for wheat cakes and one for dumplings. The wheat cake recipe is actually from the comics, which featured a page with the entire recipe on it. The dumpling recipe is the one that Peter famously messed up at MJ's apartment by burning it. A collectible that's more interesting in light of the sequel is Peter's ESU badge from when he was a teaching assistant. He mentions not having time for teaching, but that he could see himself doing it again in the future. Interestingly, Peter will be a teacher in the sequel. He's been a teacher in the comics before too, where he taught science at his old high school. Speaking of high school, there are some fun looks at Peter's early years around the time he got his powers and his early comic issues. First are his Mark 1 web shooters. They're very bulky and not nearly as compact as his current ones, but they also match his early web shooters from the comics, which he also created himself. There's also a prototype spider tracer that he says he was never able to make useful. Spider tracers are a common gadget that Peter uses in the comics, often attaching them to criminals if they're about to get away, or if he wants to follow them without them knowing. We get another gadget reference when we find the spider signal. Peter states that he couldn't really get this one to work either, but it's something Peter uses in his early comic appearances. Spider-Man would wear the signal on his belt and use its bright light to announce his arrival or as a flashlight in dark places. We also get a nod to it in the movies during a post-credit scene after Civil War. We can also find Peter's old glasses from before he got his powers. These closely resemble his glasses in the comics, with the giant circular lenses. After getting his powers, he continued to wear his glasses for a while, but eventually ditched them after they were broken by bully Flash Thompson. Another great early comic reference are these underarm web wings. Peter mentions that he made them with the intention of gliding short distances, but they never really worked. As part of his design in the early comics, Peter's suit also had web wings on them, but they were for fashion, not function. Although in Amazing Spider-Man 11, he at one point webbed himself a more practical set of wings during a battle with the Fantastic Four. By the way, if you're curious how this fight ends, Invisible Woman uses his webs to pull him back to the ground, at which point she begins flirting with him. She's able to stop them all from fighting, and before Spidey departs, he leaves her a webbed heart, which she seems pretty happy about. So even though Reed wasn't really contributing to this fight, I think he lost. Going back to the web wings though, Peter eventually gained a set for legitimate gliding as part of the Iron Spider suit. It seems that Peter's nailed the design in the sequel though, as we see the gliding function will be a prominent feature for traversal there. We can also find an old article from high school written by MJ. It shows she's had the journalistic bug from an early age, but this article also features some comic character references. She first mentions Principal Andrew, who was also their high school principal in the comics. In the article, MJ also interviews high school quarterback Flash Thompson. We talked about Flash in the first video, but just as a quick summary, he was Peter's bully in school. Later on though, Flash became more noble and even became the superhero Agent Venom. Lastly, and most interestingly, is MJ's mention of student Sally Avril. Sally is another student from the comics and desperately wanted to be famous. To accomplish that goal, she decided she wanted to be a superhero named Bluebird, despite not having any powers. She also wanted to be Spider-Man's partner and began inserting herself into fights between him and his enemies. She was always a liability in these fights since he would have to focus on protecting her the whole time. Eventually, Spider-Man had enough, and to prove to her that she needed to stop, he decided not to save her from an incoming attack. His point was that he couldn't be around to help her all the time, and that she's not cut out for being a superhero. She said she understood and agreed to retire. However, she wasn't completely done with the superhero world, since her new career choice was to be like Peter Parker and get photographs of superhero battles mid-action. When she next learned of a fight between Spider-Man and a villain, she talked her friend Jason Ionello into being her driver. By the way, if that name sounds familiar, it could be because we've seen Jason in the movies before, where he's the co-host of the Midtown News with Betty Brant. But anyway, Sally urged Jason to speed and run lights to get to the fight in time. The result was that their car was hit by a bus, and Sally was killed in the accident. So a pretty sad end for her character, but it's cool to see her referenced in the game. And who knows, we could even see Bluebird make an appearance in future games, with hopefully a happier ending. Moving forward, there are also a couple references to the Spider-Man 2 movie game, which I have a video on as well if you're feeling some nostalgia from these collectibles. The first one is a pizza hat where Peter mentions thinking that delivering pizzas while web swinging would be a fast solution, but the pizzas often end up smashed. You'll recall in the Spider-Man 2 movie, Peter also attempted delivering pizzas as Spider-Man. The movie's tie-in game had a side mission to match this, and if you were too reckless in your swinging during a delivery, the pizza would get more and more messed up. So I think this collectible is a fun nod to that. As kind of a side reference to that, if you walk up to a pizza place in the open world, you can faintly hear the music that the pizza theme from Spider-Man 2 is based on, which is a song called Funiculi Funicula.
If I flip the pizzas, Mr. Aziz will flip out.
There's also a hospital bill Peter received 3 years into being Spider-Man after being seen for a shoulder injury. Within this bill are potentially a couple Easter eggs as well. For starters, his account number and password, which are 03101963 and Orange Flame respectively. So the account number for sure looks like a reference to a comic to me, but I'm having some trouble pinpointing exactly which one since I think a digit is misplaced if I'm correct. 03011963 is the first issue for Amazing Spider-Man, not 0310. I also assume the password Orange Flame is a reference to the Human Torch, who also appeared in this issue when Spider-Man attempts to infiltrate the Baxter Building. I also thought the account number could be a reference to issue 3 from July 10th, 1963, but that feels like more of a stretch. However, that issue was the first appearance of Dr. Octopus and also featured the Human Torch. But I think the Easter egg is for Amazing Spider-Man number 1, and a digit was just accidentally misplaced on the account number, or maybe I'm looking at this all wrong and it's a different reference. Regardless, there's another cool Easter egg on this bill, and it's where it lists Kurt Connors as the referring doctor. In the comics, Kurt Connors is a doctor who later becomes the Lizard. We get another nod to the Lizard through this vial of blood. Written on it is also the code TASM06-1963. This is a reference to the Amazing Spider-Man issue 6 from 1963, which is the Lizard's first appearance. In it, Dr. Kurt Connors wants to regrow his missing arm and experiments with lizards in hopes of doing so. After experimenting on himself, he regrows his arm, but the change continued further, giving him the features of a lizard. Thankfully, Peter was able to create a serum and force Lizard to drink it, resulting in him returning back to human form. This matches Peter's commentary while analyzing this collectible, but Peter mentions it was only a temporary solution, and as we've seen in trailers, Lizard will indeed return in the sequel. In another backpack, we find a prototype web fluid that Peter tried to make at Oscorp, but he states that it was a failed attempt and that he seems to have had bad luck with Oscorp. He also mentions that Harry was interning at Oscorp at this time. On the front of the bottle is a model number TASM-1965-31. This is likely a reference to The Amazing Spider-Man issue 31, which released in 1965. However, I'm not quite sure what the relevance is, although a couple things stand out. Firstly, this is Peter's first day of college, and it's also the issue where Peter learns that Aunt May is ill. She's taken to the hospital, and it's all Peter can think about. Secondly, this is also the issue where Harry Osborn first comes into contact with Peter, and he refers to Peter as a swellhead who thinks he's better than everyone else. This is because it's common knowledge that Peter got into ESU through a science scholarship, and he seems standoffish since he's so deep in thought about Aunt May's condition. During chemistry class, Harry decides to play a prank on Peter to take him down a notch, so he has Gwen Stacy distract Peter by asking for his pen while Harry drops an unknown chemical into whatever Peter's working on. This causes Peter's project to explode, and he gets into trouble with the professor. So what I think the game could be suggesting through this reference is that maybe Peter's web fluid failed at Oscorp because Harry tampered with it as a prank, like in the comic. I can't say that for certain, but it's the thing that seemed most relevant to the referenced issue. It's kind of funny if true, too. Speaking of that chemistry professor, we get an Easter egg for him as well. In one of the backpacks, Peter finds his old college thesis that got him the job with Otto. Written on the cover is his grade and the name Professor Warren. Professor Warren is the same professor in Peter's chemistry class, but he becomes more prominent as the comics go on. His full name is Miles Warren, and he had a fascination with genetics. He also had a creepy fascination with his student Gwen Stacy, and secretly fell in love with her. After her death by the Green Goblin, Warren became obsessed with cloning. Using some cell samples of his students, he managed to successfully clone both Gwen Stacy and Peter Parker. Warren was also insane and developed himself into the villainous identity, the Jackal. So you can thank the Jackal in part for the confusing Clone Saga series. In another backpack, you can also find this apartment application. In the game's lore, about a year before the events of the game, Peter and MJ were planning on moving in together and completed this apartment application together prior to breaking up. On the application are some fun Easter eggs. The first is the name of the apartment complex, which is Bedford Towers. After getting married in the comics, MJ moved in with Peter at his apartment on Chelsea Street. However, one night while Peter was out, Venom made his first appearance, sneaking into their apartment and scaring MJ to tears. After that, MJ decided they needed to move, and she chose Bedford Towers as the location. It was actually a really fancy place, and MJ was able to afford it for them since she made so much as a fashion model. Looking lower on the application, we have Peter's driver's license number, which is broken up but can essentially be read as 1963-1998. Peter's first Amazing Spider-Man series ran from 1963 to 1998. We can also see the name of the property manager, which is Barney Muggins. Barney's wife, Mamie Muggins, was Peter's landlady at the Chelsea apartment and was the one always on Peter about the rent in the comics. However, Barney is shown up in the comics as well. In Web of Spider-Man 38, MJ decides to throw one final big party at their Chelsea apartment before moving into Bedford Towers. Mamie is furious about all the noise, but is more concerned about finding her husband, Barney. As she suspects, Barney is at the party, hiding from his wife and flirting with all of MJ's supermodel friends. So Barney's a creepy old man. At one point during the party, Peter has a glass of punch, but then has to rush off to fight Hobgoblin. During the fight, Peter's movements are sluggish, he makes a lot of mistakes, and he slurs his words while they banter. This brings them both to the quick realization that Spider-Man is drunk during this fight. Still, Peter manages to beat Hobgoblin. When he returns back to the party, he yells at the crowd asking who spiked the punch. And of course, it was Barney Muggins. Going back to the application, we can also see who Peter used for references, and they are Norman Osborn, Otto Octavius, and Aunt May. Also, I have to mention the good luck card Peter received when leaving the Daily Bugle. All the names on the card are Daily Bugle employees in the comics, but one stands out. That's Eddie Brock, who becomes Venom in the comics. It's stated that Eddie Brock isn't Venom in the game's sequel, but it's still cool to know that he exists in this universe. So perhaps we'll see him become Venom at some point in the game's series. There's also a more meta Easter egg when you find a button for the Spidey Squad, a fan club for Spider-Man. This is Insomniac's nod to the real-life Spidey Squad group, founded by YouTuber Evan Falarka. The group was made back in 2016 and is still running today, and is welcome to all fans of Spider-Man. If you'd like to check it out for yourself, I'll leave their website and socials in the description. Continuing on, one of my favorite collectibles is this business card for Nelson and Murdoch.
Oh yeah, that blind guy gave me his card in case Spider-Man ever needs a lawyer. Wait, hold on. If he's blind, how did he know I was Spider-Man?
As we discussed earlier, Matt Murdock is the blind lawyer and secret vigilante Daredevil. If you're unfamiliar with his powers, Daredevil's other senses are heightened, which together allow him to essentially see the world in a different way and pick up on details normal people can't. So that's how Matt could tell he was speaking with Spider-Man despite being blind. Daredevil and Spider-Man team up often in the comics too, so it's awesome to get a nod to an interaction between them in the game. Another interesting find is this fabric, where Peter describes wanting to make a stealth suit. I was going to talk about it in the suit section of the video, but we might as well discuss it here since it's unlockable in the game. It's the Big Time suit, and its associated power obscures you from the vision of non-alerted enemies, so they essentially can't see you. This is thematic in that in the comics, this suit is invisible. There's also a reason for the green lights on it. Peter first shows the suit to Black Cat on a mission and gives her a pair of green lenses like the ones on his suit. Anyone wearing the green lenses can see him, including himself. Peter mentioned struggling to keep track of his legs and arms while invisible, so he added the green lines on the suit so he could better see them. To everyone else though, he's invisible. The suit also has other color variations as well, depending on the mode that it's in, such as red, which helps baffle loud sonic frequencies, or white, which shows when both invisibility and the sonic mode are disabled. So it's a bit of a shame we didn't get these other color variations, but it's cool to have it in the game nonetheless. Lastly, we can find a vial of sand that Peter's collected. He states that this contains the grain of sand housing the villain Sandman, and that if he opens the vial, he's scared Sandman will be set free. It actually seems kinda cruel though that he's got Sandman just locked away in this vial. Even more cruel is that he forgot about it all this time and just now found it. He could at least take it to the Avengers or S.H.I.E.L.D. or somewhere for safekeeping. Also, I was going through Sandman's first comic appearance again, and it's pretty funny how Peter beats him. He just sucks Sandman up with a vacuum cleaner. So Sandman's getting no respect, whether it's the comics or games. There are also multiple backpack collectibles that flesh out Peter's past and give us glimpses at his early fights against some of the villains we've met. And even more interestingly, villains we haven't met in the game yet. For example, Mysterio, where Peter mentions using glass from his helmet to formulate a more durable eye lens for his costume. I really enjoyed examining all these different backpack collectibles, and they were a real highlight for me. Another series of collectibles that I really enjoyed are the J. Jonah Jameson podcast episodes. I really like that Insomniac chose to have Jameson as a podcaster instead of a newspaper publisher for this game, because I think it's a cool modernization for his character. He's also done a similar job in the comics before too, where he was a talk radio host. Then of course, we've seen this trend continue into the movies where he has his own show as well. Having him as sort of an Alex Jones type is a fun premise, and these podcast clips were always a highlight of the game. Within them, of course, are some fun Easter eggs too. For example, this one.
There was crime, sure, but nothing they couldn't handle. Of course, we do have things now we didn't have then. Maniacs who shoot electricity out of their eyes. Walking piles of sand. Nazis made of bees!
The first two referenced are, of course, Electro and Sandman respectively, but the Nazi made of bees is a character we haven't seen in the game yet, and that's Swarm. He's pretty much as Jameson described him, a Nazi comprised of individual killer bees. Swarm actually made it into the tie-in comic for the game, and even had his own modernized design for it. In that comic, Swarm is pretty much just another villain Spider-Man has to defeat, kind of like Shocker in the game, but it's cool to see him nonetheless. Jameson will also publish an episode regarding your new outfit, if you choose to wear the Spider-Punk suit.
People, I always thought Spider-Man was a few geese short of a gaggle, but this confirms it. As if that atrocious white spider wasn't enough, I've had repeated sightings of him in a new outfit. Some sort of punk rock-inspired thing that makes sane people want to tear out their eyeballs with a rusty spoon. Now, I was around for the birth of punk rock, and I did not care for it then. It's a flagrant declaration of disrespect for authority, and if Spider-Man is going down that route... Oh, no. No, I just had a terrifying thought. What if this isn't the Spider-Man we know, but some sort of metal mohawk-wearing copycat? What if there's more than one?
With the Across the Spider-Verse film that's recently released, I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with Hobie Brown, aka Spider-Punk. He's from an alternate universe, and I think it's fun that Jameson's fear over multiple Spider-Men could be a nod to the Spider-Verse as a whole, where there are endless variations of Spider-Men. Insomniac Spider-Man actually appeared in a Spider-Verse-style comic event called Spider-Geddon, so his fears are very much a reality. The Spider-Punk suit itself is pretty awesome in the game too, and I especially love its suit power, where you can use your guitar to create a powerful shockwave AoE attack.
Guys, the guards at Rikers miss you so much!
In another episode, Jameson also makes a couple references to his involvement with Scorpion's creation, which is indeed true.
I want to address the matter of the Scorpion right now. Yes, I paid for the procedure that empowered him. We desperately needed someone to bring down Spider-Man. It's not my fault the treatments drove him crazy. It's that ivory tower elite scientist who was so hungry for my money, he didn't take proper precautions. No one believes in personal responsibility more than J. Jonah Jameson. But in this, I can categorically say, I am blameless.
If you're unfamiliar with the story, Scorpion, aka Matt Gargan, was originally hired by Jameson as a private investigator, tasked with following Peter to learn how he managed to always get pictures of Spider-Man. Peter's spider sense helped him evade Mac, and the investigation went nowhere. Jameson wasn't bothered though, since he had a new idea. He learned of a local scientist named Farley Stillwell who could fuse animal abilities together. For example, getting a fish to breathe air like a rat and a rat to swim like a fish. Jameson paid Gargan to undergo the experiment with the goal of creating a new superpowered being, one who could defeat Spider-Man and become an actual hero to the city. It was decided that Gargan's DNA would be fused with the abilities of a scorpion, since scorpions are natural predators of spiders. The experiment was a success, increasing Gargan's strength and speed, and Stillwell also created a cybernetic tail for Gargan to use. However, the experiment had a negative effect on Gargan's mind, driving him insane. The result was Scorpion going on a rampage across town and even threatening Jameson at times, forcing him to rely on Spider-Man to save him. So Jameson essentially created an even worse problem. In a different podcast episode, Jameson also addresses a concern from listener May from Queens.
And now for listener emails. May from Queens writes, "You're so full of anger and I wish you'd get help managing it. It's terrible for your health."
Aunt May's house is in Queens, so I think it's a safe bet that Aunt May was the writer Jameson was addressing. It also sounds like a very Aunt May thing to say, since she's often on Peter about his health in the comics. Also in the comics, Aunt May has followed Jameson's reporting of Spider-Man, and she even believes Spider-Man to be the menace Jameson said he was, often putting Peter in a weird position. I also want to take a moment to compliment the fantastic performance of Darren DePaul, who voices Jameson in the game. He really nails the character, and a lot of his line readings feel so perfect. I also want to credit writer Christos Gage, who wrote all the Jameson episodes, because he gives Darren a lot of fun content to work with. Together, they're a great pairing, and the Jameson podcast was one of my favorite aspects of the game. So just to enjoy it a little bit more, I'll play a quick highlight reel of some of my favorite moments from the podcast before moving on.
Our next caller reports a problem I saw coming a mile away. Go ahead, ma'am.
Well, I was coming out of the bathtub last night when I glanced out my window, and what do I see? Spider-Man, swinging by like he owns the place. I was naked!
Madam, you have my sympathies. Just imagine what sort of deviant personality would dress up like that in the first place. And it's a short step from there to Peeping Tom activity. Folks, it doesn't matter if you live on the first floor or the 31st. Keep your curtains drawn! Lock your windows! A webbed pervert walks among us! I got an interesting tip today. Remember that barbaric beast named the Rhino? Apparently last night he almost escaped from his cell in the raft. How, you ask? Well, no one there seems to know, but they assure me he's been relocated to a more secure cell. Now, I'm no expert on Supermax prisons, but isn't the whole point of them that there isn't anything else more secure? I mean, he's a 700-pound maniac with an indestructible horn. If there's a more secure cell, why wasn't he in it? Let's talk about Halloween, folks. It may be good fun for the kids to dress up as a cowboy or astronaut or ballerina and trick-or-treat, but this trend of grown adults glorifying the likes of Spider-Man by dressing up as them is, especially in the times we live in, disturbing. What say you, Gino from the Bronx?
Yeah, well, I get your point, but my girlfriend got this sexy Spider-Girl costume, and it really spices things up. Know what I'm saying?
Huh. I most certainly do not. J. Jonah Jameson is not one to be judgmental, but you, sir, are an extremely disturbed man. Goodbye! You night owls may have seen lights flickering out at the Raft Supermax prison last night. Sadly, it was not because one of their inmates got the chair. Guess who's confirmed to be back in town? That feline felon, the Black Cat. Seems she led Spider-Man on a merry chase before getting away. Ever notice how that happens a lot with him and her? Funny how he can hold on to a dinosaur man or a human rhino with no problem, but a mere slip of a girl gives him so much trouble. Look, it's not that long ago when I was a young man myself, I get it. And I said a gams, a shapely derriere, a few batted eyelashes, And a hormone-addled youth can easily get hornswoggled, which is exactly why Spider-Man has no business handling this. Leave it to the professionals. We have lady police officers now. Maybe this is a chance for them to prove they're as good as men, which I have no doubt about, but there are less forward-thinking people out there. You youngsters won't recall, but there was an earlier Black Cat, a criminal from the old school. And of course, like everything else these days, they had to reboot it with a woman. Now, no one loves women more than J. Jonah Jameson. In a respectful, non-harassing way, of course. Now, typically, I don't like to trash talk other... Who put this note here? What's a content creator? That means nothing, Jared. Those are two meaningless words that put together make one meaningless phrase, Jared!
The last series of collectibles I want to discuss are the various unlockable suits and their suit powers. Let's first begin with the comic-based suits and their origin. We'll begin with the Spider-Noir suit. This one is based on an alternate universe Peter Parker, one set in the 1930s, and Peter created this suit using Uncle Ben's World War I era airman uniform. You'll also see that the game suit has a gun holstered on the hip, and that's because this universe's Peter Parker is unafraid to use guns on enemies. Spider-Man Noir is actually a really awesome character, and I'm sure a lot of fans are familiar with him from the Into the Spider-Verse movie. If you'd like to check out more of his world though, I'd recommend either checking out his comic series or the game Spider-Man Shattered Dimensions, where he's one of the four playable characters, and a few missions take place in his universe. I also have a video on that game if you'd like to check it out as well. The next suit is the Scarlet Spider suit, and this is based on the suit worn by Peter Parker clone Ben Reilly. He actually chose this name, naming himself Ben after Uncle Ben, and Reilly is Aunt May's maiden name. In the comics, Ben throws his outfit together using an all-red bodysuit and a hoodie he saw in a shop window. His suit power in the game is pretty cool since it allows you to produce hollow decoys in the area to trick enemies. I thought this was pretty useful, keeping some of the pressure off you, but I also like it thematically since they're essentially clones like Ben Reilly. Let's next look at the Spider Armor Mark 1. In the comics, Spider-Man created this armor to better protect himself against the new enforcers. It protected him well, but didn't last the whole fight as Spider-Man broke out of it after he was hit with a freeze blast. Still, it's a really cool looking outfit from one of Spider-Man's earlier comics, so I'm glad to see it used in the game. Next up is Spider Armor Mark 2. At one point in the comics, Peter lost his spider sense, so he made this bulletproof suit to keep him safe during battles. So it's fitting that the suit power for this suit is that it becomes bulletproof as well. There's also the Secret War suit, based on a comic series called Secret War. Not to be confused with Secret Wars, the big event featuring a wide swath of Marvel characters and locations. Secret War Singular is a story where Nick Fury creates a small Black Ops team to secretly infiltrate Latveria. Spider-Man is part of that team and uses this unique suit for the series. Well, sort of. He's primarily using his classic red and blue suit throughout it, and the new suit only shows up for a couple panels and can be easy to miss. But still, the suit was designed for this series. The series itself is pretty good though, and I recommend checking it out, especially for the beautiful artwork by Gabriel Delato. Each panel is a joy to look at, and it's a lot of fun to flip through. The Secret War comic was also loosely adapted in the game Marvel Ultimate Alliance 2, another game I'd recommend checking out if you haven't before. Next up is the Negative suit. I think the suit is sort of a hybrid of a couple ideas, the first of which is that it's the negative version of the Advanced suit. However, I think it's also based on the Negative suit in the comics, which isn't related to Martin Lee. In the comics, Spider-Man has appeared in a similar suit after being sucked through a portal into the Negative Zone. However, there was also a separate comic where Spider-Man was corrupted by Mr. Negative, which changed his suit into more of a red and gray. The game suit obviously isn't adapting that version, but I wanted to show it in case anyone was curious how it looked in relation to Martin Lee. As we discussed in the Part 1 video, there's also a death state where Spider-Man gets corrupted by Mr. Negative and gets overwhelmed with negative energy. This could have actually been a pretty awesome alternate suit too. The Negative suit also has a great suit power where you unleash a negative blast of your own against enemies. I especially enjoyed using this against the demons, giving them a taste of their own medicine. We also have the electrically insulated suit. In the comics, it was created by Peter in Amazing Spider-Man 425 to help him battle Electro. I see the suit get a lot of hate online, but I think it looks really good, both in the games and the comics. It also has a great suit power where you can electrify your gauntlets to deal shock damage with melee attacks. This is especially useful during hideout challenges that require you to electrify a number of enemies at once. Next is the Fear Itself suit from the series of the same name. In that series, an ancient Asgardian named the Serpent has been released and threatens to destroy Earth. To combat this, Tony Stark uses an Asgardian forge to create weapons blessed by Odin. Spider-Man gets these bladed gauntlets, which transform the look of his suit as well. So that's why he has those gauntlets in the game. The associated suit power is pretty powerful, quadrupling your damage, making quick work of enemies. Knowing that the suit is based on Asgardian weaponry, I think the suit ability feels fittingly powerful. We talked about Spider Armor Mark II, so now let's look at Mark III. In the comics, Peter used the suit to help him fight against the Sinister Six when they teamed up again to assist the dying Dr. Octopus with his last-ditch plan. Since it's meant to withstand the abilities of the Sinister Six, it's a pretty durable armor and even has jet boosters in the feet. In the game, it feels like a step up from the Mark II armor, since its suit power allows you to reflect bullets back at enemies, which is pretty satisfying. The next suit is a popular one, and that's the Spider-Man 2099 suit. This Spider-Man is Miguel O'Hara from the year 2099, and Miguel worked for the company Alchemax, who were experimenting with gene splicing. In their database, they even had superheroes like Spider-Man, and they hoped they could add DNA like this into humans. However, during a human trial attempting to integrate that DNA into a participant, it instead turned them into a monstrous beast, and they collapsed and died. An employee at Alchemax saw this as an opportunity and tried to kill Miguel using this device, using the Spider-Man genetic structure on him, thinking that that one in particular would be too much to survive. He was wrong, and Miguel was imbued with unique abilities similar to Spider-Man. For example, sharp talons on his hands and feet, which allowed him to scale buildings. I like that the game stays true to this, as you can see this outfit includes sharp talons on the fingers. In the comics, Miguel's suit allows him to glide, which the game's associated suit power aims to simulate by temporarily creating low gravity when triggered. This felt pretty cool when triggered during traversal and was kind of fun just floating around for a bit. By the way, if you're a fan of Spider-Man 2099 or curious to learn more about him, I'd highly recommend his comic series from the 90s. I'd also recommend Spider-Man Shattered Dimensions again and its sequel Edge of Time, both of which feature him prominently, especially Edge of Time. I just happen to have videos on both of those games as well if you're interested. There's also an alternate version of the 2099 suit you can pick, which is this white variation. This isn't just a recolor for the game either, and is another suit of Miguel's in the comics. Peter Parker actually made it for him, and it's a highly advanced version of the original. For example, it features boot thrusters in the feet to quickly get Miguel into the air, allowing him to glide around easier. In the game, its suit power is a concussive strike, which launches enemies back when you strike them. I didn't use this a lot, but when I did, it was pretty awesome. We next have the Spider Armor Mark IV. In the comics, Peter at one point had his own company, Parker Industries. Using these resources, he created the Mark IV armor, which featured a bunch of upgrades. In the game, it creates an energy shield which temporarily absorbs all damage, which is handy if you're in a tight spot and need some breathing room. This suit is amongst my most used in the game, since I think it looks incredible. Insomniac did a great job bringing it to life, and I think it looks especially great during nighttime, and I use it a lot while night swinging. Next up is one of the most unique skins in the game, and it's the Vintage Comic Book Suit. It's one of my favorites, and looks like it was ripped straight out of a comic book or animated series. However, one downside is that it can be a bit jarring if used during a cutscene and might take you out of the moment. This was actually a concern of Brian Inahar's, and he told Kinda Funny Games that this suit in particular was originally a much earlier unlock, but he had the team push it back farther in the unlock list, and feared that players would accidentally use it during dramatic story moments and lessen the impact. I actually made that mistake during the mission where Peter first trains Miles how to fight, and although this wasn't really an emotional scene, its impact was lessened a bit due to the stark contrast of how Spider-Man looks compared to everything else. That being said, it's an incredible outfit and one of my favorites to use when patrolling the city. It also has a fun suit power, Quips. It won't exactly aid you in a fight, but if you're wanting to roleplay as Peter Parker further, this gives you the option to quip more than usual.
Join me, and together we can bring peace and prosperity to the city! No? Worth a shot!
Originally, Insomniac planned on having Peter quip a lot during fights, but after some playtesting, they realized that the quip frequency led to jokes becoming repetitive, and that it would require an unrealistic amount of extra VO lines to even things out.
Oh no, I'm starting to repeat my quips. I should hire a joke writer.
To get a sense of that, Brian Inahar presented an early gameplay clip of their rapidly quipping Spider-Man.
Out of sight, out of mind.
And see.
Take a break. Come on, big boy. Bad guy, corner pop. Butterfingers. Oh, down already. Been putting protein in his oatmeal.
In that clip, it's also cool that you can see different gameplay animations and features that didn't make it into the main game. For example, the arrows on the ground showing the direction thrown objects will go. Also, Spider-Man jumping on that brute's back and hitting him looks really cool, and I'm curious why that was removed. Maybe it slowed down the pace of the fights too much? I'm not really sure. Still, I think Insomniac were right to make the changes that they did, and it's fun seeing glimpses at their early ideas and how much the game has evolved since then. For our next unlockable outfit, let's look at the Last Stand suit. This comes from a comic where Kraven and his family are hunting down different spider-powered allies of Spider-Man. They actually killed two of them and had a few others, including Madame Web, held captive. Peter was enraged and took the fight to the Kravens, and in his rage he was able to fight through them all for a final showdown with Kraven himself. Madame Web warned the others to prevent Peter from killing Kraven, since she was able to foresee the outcome of Peter breaking his no-kill rule here. What she saw is that it leads him down a dark path where he becomes more of an anti-hero, and we see him in the Last Stand suit at a moment where he kills Dr. Octopus by impaling him with a piece of his own tentacle. So this suit is associated with a harder-edged Spider-Man, which is always fun to see. It's also a really good-looking suit in the game. I like its associated suit power a lot too, mostly because I think it's thematic to this darker Spider-Man. It's called Unrelenting Fury, and when triggered, it allows you to break the enemy's block and shields, and it prevents them from interrupting your attacks, so you can just viciously pummel anyone as needed. This next suit is another unique one, and one I imagine a lot of people have questions on, and that's Spirit Spider. So in the comics, this is a Peter Parker from another universe who goes by the name The Amazing Spider. He's also a lot more powerful than our Spider-Man, and criminals are very scared of him. For example, Rhino at one point chooses to immediately turn himself into the police instead of fighting him. We later find out that the Amazing Spider is so powerful because he's found a way to transport Spider-Man from other universes into his universe, and then he kills them for their power, boosting his own power in the process. Surprisingly, the person pushing the Amazing Spider to do this is actually Uncle Ben. In this universe, Uncle Ben didn't die, but he's also not the positive influence that 616 Uncle Ben was. For example, Ben's slogan is, "With great power comes a great responsibility to stay powerful." So it's Ben pushing the Amazing Spider to drain the other Spider-Men. Our 616 Spider-Man is close to being their next victim, but he's able to get the Amazing Spider to listen to him. He convinces him that what he's doing isn't heroic and that he needs to stop. Uncle Ben doesn't agree and makes a last-ditch effort to drain 616 Peter. The Amazing Spider jumps in between them and accidentally gets stuck by Ben's device. This kills the Amazing Spider, and we later see that he's been sent to hell. If things weren't strange enough for you yet, this story also contains an alternate universe Sorcerer Supreme, who's Bruce Banner instead of Doctor Strange. At one point, Bruce frees the Amazing Spider from hell, but also infused him with the spirits and power of the Repentant Damned. With that, he received the Spirit Spider look, although in the comic he refers to himself as Ghost Spider. However, Gwen Stacy's taken on that name more prominently, so I think Spirit Spider works better in this case. So overall, a pretty cool and obscure character, and one I'm really glad Insomniac chose to use as an alternate outfit, since it's definitely one of the most unique suits in the game. It's also a lot of fun swinging around and terrorizing criminals in this suit. I also love his suit power, where he creates a field of ethereal energy that damages anyone that gets nearby. I love the effects of it, especially with all the ghostly skulls floating around. Similar to the animated suit, this one is especially crazy to see in cutscenes too. Next up though is Spider UK. This is another alternate universe Spider-Man, Billy Braddock, who's also a rookie Captain Britain. Billy becomes aware of the villain Morlun, who's seeking out different spider-powered individuals across different universes to kill them. Billy brings this to the attention of his people, and he's given a talisman that allows him to travel across the multiverse to protect and recruit different Spider-Men as part of the Spider-Verse comic event. In the game, you can actually see the red spider talisman on his wrist, which I thought was a nice touch. We talked about this next one in the part 1 video, and that's the wrestling suit. In the comics, after receiving his powers, Peter decided to earn some money by competing in a wrestling match against Crusher Hogan. In the 616 universe, the suit he wore was a more casual outfit with a webbed mask. The game's design instead follows the Ultimate Universe with a more put-together wrestling suit. The suit power is very thematic too, allowing you to web rodeo enemies without first webbing them up. Our next suit is the Scarlet Spider 2 suit. This is the suit worn by the first Peter Parker clone, known as Kane. As the first clone, Kane was an imperfect creation. He was visually deformed, mentally unstable, and slowly degenerating. He believed that Ben Reilly was the real Peter Parker for a time, not a clone, so he was jealous that Ben was a normal person not going through the same struggles as him. So he became an antagonist of Ben's for a while. Eventually, during the events of Spider Island, Kane was dropped into a tank filled with a cure, which stabilized his DNA, making him a perfect clone, like Ben. Kane ended up becoming a hero in his own right, heading to Texas and donning the Scarlet Spider suit. Kane is a pretty interesting character from the comics, so it's cool to see his suit utilized in the game. Next up is the Iron Spider suit. This suit was created by Tony Stark during the Civil War series, and it features a host of new upgrades, for example, functional web wings. We talked earlier about them being mostly for style in the original comics, but Stark made them useful, allowing Peter to glide when needed. More famously though, this suit also gave Spider-Man his Iron Spider arms. In the game, this Iron Spider suit doesn't include a suit power, and instead the Iron Spider arms belong to the movie version of the suit. However, there's a really cool detail between the Iron Spider arms and the game's two Iron Spider suits. Like I mentioned, the suit power is unlocked through the movie Iron Spider suit, so the design of the arms matches the color scheme of the movie suit. If you use the spider arms on all the other suits, they maintain this design, excluding one. If you wear the comic Iron Spider suit and equip it with the iron arms, they're instead all gold to match their look in the comics. I thought that was a really incredible detail to include in the game, and I really appreciate Insomniac going the extra mile like that for fans of the suit. The arms are also just really fun to use in general. They can bypass the block and shields of enemies, and they give you extra range, and they're all around just a joy to use, so I'm really glad they made it into the game. Next are another couple unique suits, such as the Spider Clan suit. This is based on a manga-verse Spider-Man comic, where Spider-Man is part of a ninja clan called the Spider Clan. His sensei, who's essentially this universe's Uncle Ben, dies at the hand of Venom, and Peter aims to get revenge for his death. There's also the Aaron Aikman spider suit. This is another alternate universe Spider-Man, and Aaron Aikman is a gifted scientist and focused his research on the medical applications of insect venoms. One day, he experimented on himself, attempting to resequence his DNA to include spider genes. This gave him spider abilities, and he created a cybernetic suit to further expand on his powers. For example, web spinners in his gauntlets and jet propulsion boots. This next suit is a pretty obscure one, but equally cool. That's the Cyborg suit from Spider-Man issue 21. In it, Spider-Man is beaten by a character named Solo, but saved by another character named Cyborg X. Spider-Man then wakes up with different modifications added onto him. At first, he believed he had been turned into a cyborg. He quickly learns that's not the case when he speaks to Dr. Oscar McDonald. He explains that the robot arm is actually just a cast, allowing Spider-Man to maintain full functionality of his arm at an accelerated healing rate. The new eye lens was also added onto the suit to replace Spider-Man's damaged eyepiece, so they aren't permanent applications, just temporary enhancements. In the game, I thought Insomniac did a good job faithfully recreating the suit with all the stitching and bandages to complete the look. So it's a really cool inclusion, and I like how Insomniac are going to some more obscure comic tales to bring us some of the more unique Spider-Man suits. Next up is one that's commonly used as an alternate suit in Spider-Man games, the Bombastic Bagman. In the comic, shortly after receiving the symbiote suit, Spider-Man was curious about its composition, so he takes it to Reed Richards of the Fantastic Four to analyze it. Spider-Man's shocked and horrified to learn that the suit is actually alive and bonding to Peter. Peter wants it off immediately, and the Fantastic Four are able to help him remove it. However, Peter no longer has a suit, but needs a way to conceal his identity, even from them. Johnny Storm has a solution, and it's to give Peter an old Fantastic Four suit and a paper bag as a mask. On his way home, Spider-Man even stopped a crime in the suit. Unfortunately for him, police and reporters were quick to the scene and wanted to interview who they believed to be a new hero or member of the Fantastic Four. To add to his embarrassment, he also learns that Johnny attached a Kick Me sign to his back. Luckily for the game's Peter, there's no Kick Me sign, and Insomniac did a really good job on this Fantastic Four suit. It honestly makes me wish we had a modern Fantastic Four game. I think it's about time. Regardless, it's a fun suit to use in the game, and I love that Insomniac included it. Sticking with the Fantastic Four theme, Insomniac also included the Future Foundation suit. After the presumed death of the Human Torch, the remaining members in Spider-Man listen to a recorded message Johnny left in case he died as part of his will. What Johnny left Spider-Man was his place on the Fantastic Four team. So for a time, Spider-Man joined the Fantastic Four, now calling themselves Future Foundation. Together, they wore these all-white suits, and I think that's a really cool look for Spider-Man. But those are all of the suits inspired by the comics. Still, there are a bunch of other suits that are either original designs or from the movies. The movie suits in particular are some of my most used suits in the game, somewhat for nostalgia, but also due to their high level of detail. Something about these suits just looks so great in gameplay and cutscenes. I especially appreciate that Insomniac chose to add in the suits from both the Andrew Garfield Amazing Spider-Man film and the Tobey Maguire suit from the Raimi films. I've always really loved these suits, and it really enhances the game getting to use them. It almost feels like playing a new movie featuring that version. These two suits in particular took a while to make it into the game though. Amazing Spider-Man wasn't released until the Remastered Edition, and the Raimi suit took a few months itself, even though the process to include it began before the game even released. Sadly, the joy of the Raimi suit was somewhat tainted by fans back in the day, with many of them harassing Insomniac about not including it. Then, when it finally released, those same fans assumed it was in thanks to their bullying of Insomniac. It wasn't, and the delay was due to licensing, approvals, testing, etc., so I just want to reinforce again that it's not okay to harass developers about a game, and you are not entitled to do so.
Stop it. Get some help.
That being said, both suits were worth the wait and look incredible in the game. The Insomniac original suits are really creative and look great too, though. One of the most unique original suits in the game is the Arachnid Rider suit, which has that animated, manga-style look to it. It was also based on the Kamen Rider TV series, if you're curious about the design. I'll admit, I wasn't initially a big fan of the Arachnid Rider suit, but it's definitely grown on me over time since it is so unique. Another suit that really grew on me was the Armored Advance suit. It never really stands out to me much on the suit selection screen, but I like it a lot in action. Easily my favorite of the original designs, though, is the Velocity suit, created by comic book artist Adi Granov. I imagine this was a common favorite for a lot of fans, since it even received its own comic series, taking place after the events of the main game. The comic describes Spider-Man's reasons for creating the suit, which originally stemmed from a fight against Swarm, the Nazi bee guy that we discussed earlier. After getting stung a lot and having pieces of his suit rip, he decides he needs to start workshopping an armored suit. He also encounters a speedster in the city and begins adding elements to his new armored suit to help him keep pace with her. This goes along with the suit's power in the game, which allows for faster sprinting and the ability to knock down enemies while running. It's a pretty cool power and makes you feel like the Juggernaut. Another great original outfit is the Resilient suit. It has that sleek armor design, and I was even more excited to learn who designed it. Earlier, I recommended the Secret War series mainly for the incredible artwork by Gabriel Del Otto, while he's also the man who designed the Resilient suit. I should also mention the suit you get when you 100% the game, or maybe lack of a suit is more accurate. You'll now be able to select Peter in his underwear and mask, like we saw at the end of the Scorpion Hallucination mission. It's a pretty ridiculous look, which makes it really fun to use at times, especially during certain cutscenes. One of Insomniac's designers also had the fun idea to reference an early line of Peter's by incorporating that detail into the suit.
Not good. Can't have people taking pictures of my 3 chest hairs.
As you can see on the suit model, Peter legit only has 3 chest hairs. I also like its suit power. It's called Equalizer, and when triggered, everyone gets KO'd after one hit, including you. This is a very high-risk ability, but it's fun to play around with and super satisfying when you use it successfully. Another detail I like about this suit is how your footsteps sound different compared to other suits. As you'll see in this clip, Spider-Man's steps in the advanced suit sound like normal footsteps with shoes on, where Spider-Man's bare footsteps have more of a slapping sound to them. So it's a pretty funny suit overall, and I think it's a decently fitting reward for 100%. I can't say it's super exciting and motivated me to grind for it, but I'm at least happy it's in there. What I think would have been an even better 100% suit, though, is a Spider-Cop suit. Surprisingly, a Spider-Cop suit was actually planned but never released, as we can see from the YouTube channel Jedi Josh, which I'll have linked in the description. So Insomniac did build a Spider-Cop suit, and it looks really awesome, but I'm not sure why they never released it, especially since they continually added new suits to the game after launch up to 2021 for Spider-Man No Way Home. So it's a real shame that they didn't ever include Spider-Cop. Interestingly enough, a glimpse of it was also shown during a panel in the Spider-Geddon comic series. With all these various suits, it's fun to show them off in unique ways, which brings me to photo mode. If I'm being totally honest with you, I'm not usually a huge photo mode guy, but I was really blown away with all the different features it has in this game, and pretty quickly I found out why people get so addicted to photo mode and trying out different variations. Just to give a sample of the different customizations, I'll go through some of them as I try them out. One of my favorites right off the bat is how you can quickly swap between your different unlocked suits. I had a lot of fun swapping between them all to test which ones I thought looked best for that particular shot, and whether it worked well with the lighting. Speaking of which, I was also impressed with how you can control the lighting in the area. It was handy brightening up shots that were in the shade, and it was cool rotating the world's lighting to fit my needs. I was also surprised at how much I enjoyed using the sticker feature, where you can pick a sticker to place on the screen. There's actually a pretty extensive backlog of ones to choose from, and I really enjoyed trying out different ones to add to the scenery. I also thought it was pretty funny and clever how you can choose to have Spidey go into a selfie pose. This pose looks great, and you can still move his head around to get the proper angle that you want, so I thought that was a really great inclusion. You can also select different frames for your photo. These for me were the most fun to cycle through, since they are all so creative and you get a lot of fun options to play around with. I thought these were really cool and provided some good inspiration to build around. But like I said, I'm a novice at photo mode, so on screen I'll have a slideshow showcasing what more talented photographers have been able to create in the game while I wrap up my thoughts. So overall, I was really blown away with all the customization features included here. It's really fun to play around with them all, and it's easy to get lost in the creativity of creating each shot. I also just really appreciate the lengths Insomniac went to flesh it out for fans. This feature wasn't initially available at launch and was slightly delayed past launch, but I think it was totally worth it. You can tell Insomniac put a lot of thought and creativity into this mode, and the result is a really fun feature for fans to sink their teeth into. So if you haven't really dabbled with photo mode before, I'd recommend giving it a shot and see if it's up your alley, since I found it to be surprisingly addicting. But now that we've gone through all the various collectibles and different things to do around the city, let's next talk about some of the more core gameplay mechanics, namely combat and traversal. Looking back on how fun the combat of Marvel Spider-Man is, you might be surprised to learn that it was an area that Insomniac were pretty nervous about developing, since they didn't have much experience with melee-based combat from their prior games. Still, they knew they wanted to make it feel like an Insomniac-style game, which is where the gadgets come in. In Insomniac's other games, for example Ratchet & Clank, gadgets play a big role in the combat. so it's not too surprising to see gadgets used in a similar degree in Marvel Spider-Man. I think they did a good job on the gadgets in the game too. Each one feels unique from the other, and they shine in different scenarios. For example, those troublesome minigunners in the DLC whose Gatling gun you can't dodge can be remedied using your electric webs, which stun them momentarily. It's also a lot of fun to mix and match different combinations of gadgets to come up with effective ways to dispatch enemies. For example, one of my favorites was using a web blast on a group, and then using the concussive blast to stick them to buildings and objects. I also enjoyed using the suspension matrix gadget after first hitting enemies with a web blast. This provided a lot of breathing room and made it so I could yank them down to the ground for an instant KO. So I think the gadgets are a lot of fun to mix and match and add a lot to the combat of the game. However, I would like to see Insomniac lean into the melee side of combat more in the future, as well as add more layers to it. When you're using melee, it can start to feel a bit button mashy since you're pretty much just spamming square to complete your combo. I often found myself using the uppercut ability in fights, not because I felt I needed to launch an enemy, but more just to change things up and feel like I had more control over my combos. I should mention that although I haven't really revisited the Miles Morales game ahead of this one, I do believe it improves on the melee combat, but we'll dive deeper into that in another video. I do, however, really like the theme of combat Insomniac chose for Spider-Man, as they internally referred to him as an acrobatic improviser. I think that's a great way to describe his combat style and feels very on theme. In comics and films, we often see him dodging and flipping around during fights, reacting to the chaos as best he can thanks to his spider sense. Insomniac nailed that feeling in the game, since the combat felt very reactionary in a good way, where I felt like I was frequently dodging incoming attacks and then quickly following things up with my own attacks. It's a great back and forth between you and the enemies, and the unpredictable nature of it made the fights really exciting. I think the animation team did a great job of really selling that feeling too, with all the incredible acrobatic animations. That goes double for the takedown animations, which I thought were really satisfying to pull off, even if I had seen the same ones often throughout the course of the game. So even though I criticized the melee attacks in particular, the overall feeling of the combat as a whole was done very well, not only due to the thematic and fast-paced nature of the fights, but also thanks to things like gadgets and suit powers that provided a lot of variety to each battle. As the player, I felt like I had a lot of agency and control over how I wanted to approach each fight moment to moment, and I enjoyed puzzling out how I wanted to attack each enemy, or what combination of abilities I wanted to use against certain enemy types. I also appreciate that despite Insomniac's concerns approaching melee combat, they still did their best to create a style that feels unique to them. I think it could have been very easy to lean into other games as a safety net, for example, the Arkham combat system from those games. The Arkham series in general is often compared to the Spider-Man games, so I'm glad that Insomniac managed to differentiate themselves from it. For example, having Spider-Man's combat include more aerial-based abilities, pushing the player to get Spider-Man up in the air and control the battlefield from up high. Batman is a very grounded character, so they feel very different in that regard. Insomniac also better utilizes the environment in their combat. I think I've mentioned this before, but I always appreciate when games incorporate the environment into gameplay because it makes the world feel more lively and immersive. Insomniac did an excellent job at that because I felt like I always had something to throw at enemies, whether that be an enemy's car door, a motorcycle, or a sewer drain cover, all of which I'm going to pretend wouldn't kill them on impact. The environment feels highly interactable, and I think that's a real boon to the combat. The open world makes the combat a lot of fun too, since there are plenty of fights that take place on rooftops. This usually had me rethink my gadget selection, since there may not be walls to attach my enemies to. What I typically opted for was my concussive blast again to send enemies flying off the roof. Insomniac anticipated this, and decided they wanted to stay true to Spider-Man's no-kill rule, so instead of letting the enemy plummet into the pavement, Insomniac added a feature where a falling enemy has a web line attached to them, pulling them to the closest wall. Interestingly, this wasn't the first method Insomniac landed on. Originally, one of their ideas was to use web parachutes to bring enemies safely down to the ground. This is actually thematic to the comics, where Spider-Man has made web parachutes for himself if he wasn't able to hook a web line to a nearby building. I think I like the web line over the web parachute for the game as well, but regardless, I really like the lengths Insomniac are going to make the world and combat feel true to Spider-Man. The same goes for the traversal, which I believe is Insomniac's crowning achievement. Insomniac were known for having good traversal in their other games, but I imagine a Spider-Man game would still be pretty daunting, since the web swinging has such a high bar for fans. Prior to Marvel's Spider-Man, Spider-Man 2 was known for having the best web swinging, since it was the first to allow Spider-Man to attach his webs to buildings. This was also a more challenging web swinging system to master, since the player needed to plan ahead with their swing or likely collide with a wall. For a lot of fans, that challenge still makes it the definitive web swinging system, but Insomniac took a different approach. They didn't want the player pancaking onto walls and really wanted to maintain the momentum you'd expect from an experienced Spider-Man. So the web swinging in the game is admittedly very simple, but incredibly cinematic. So what it may lack in challenge, it more than makes up for visually and thematically. From an outsider's perspective, it probably looks very challenging. I played this in front of my parents once, and they seemed impressed by all the maneuvers I was pulling off in the game. When they asked how I was doing it, I told them I was just holding down the right trigger and pressing forward. I'm oversimplifying to a degree, but not by a lot, and I don't mean it as a criticism. I'm actually impressed at how much depth there is to the traversal of the city, with controls that are still very approachable to beginners. I also think it looks so complex at times due to all the different contextual animations for what you're interacting with in the city. Insomniac went to great lengths to create animations for different objects you might encounter while traversing to hinder as much momentum-breaking collisions as possible. A great example are the fire escapes. Brian Inahar stated that he forced the team to keep fire escapes on buildings, which also meant that animations needed to be created just for those. So if you decide to vertically ascend a building along a fire escape, there's a unique animation where Spider-Man will leap up it. If you're swinging across the side of a building and would collide with a fire escape, Spider-Man will leap through it. Through all my hours of web swinging in this game, it was pretty rare for me to encounter something that would slow Spider-Man's momentum in the city, and for the most part I was really impressed at how natural and free-flowing the traversal is. It's also incredibly relaxing. There are plenty of times where I just get lost in thought while swinging through the city, and I have trouble ending my play sessions when I'm just cruising around. I'm pretty amazed at how great the swinging feels overall, so I really applaud what Insomniac were able to accomplish with it. Given their reputation prior to this game, I was pretty confident the traversal would be good, but I didn't think it would be this good. In my opinion, they really set a new bar for web-swinging expectations in Spider-Man games. I also just want to take a moment to compliment how seamless the camera is in this game. The camera is typically a feature that if done well, you never notice it, but if done poorly, you're constantly noticing it. Insomniac is of course the former, which is really impressive considering everything you're doing in the game. During a GDC presentation by Doug Sheehan, he describes some of their initial hurdles with the camera and traversal when performing a variety of moves, and even shows an early example.
In this video, from an early vertical slice, you'll see some of the issues with the everything is a special snowflake and how that kind of breaks down. You'll see that going from move to move would cause a change in framing and field of view that could kind of muddle the perception of speed, and rapid sequencing of moves would create a very noisy relationship between the world, the character, and the view.
That looked pretty jarring and makes me appreciate the final version a lot more. The camera now follows the player in a very smooth and consistent way and hardly ever breaks the flow or immersion of traversal. Doug even mentions the camera being used strategically to give the player a better sense of speed at moments. For example, when you're launching off a point, the camera trails behind momentarily to give the player the feeling that they're blasting away from the camera before it can catch up. During that same GDC presentation, Doug also showed an example of how the field of view and camera adjust to give players that sense of speed.
So here you'll be able to see all of that coming together to show the sense of speed. There's a little bit of debugger on the side to give you a better idea of how the field of view and follow distance are changing as it goes through the action.
I think this is also a good example of how many small details went into making the traversal feel so quick and smooth. It's so seamless that you really don't notice it, but there are a lot of little things happening moment to moment to accomplish that immersion. So again, I'm really impressed with Insomniac's skill and attention to detail here. And as a whole, I think the gameplay in general is top-notch in Marvel Spider-Man. I think Insomniac created a really good foundation for both the combat and traversal, so I'm excited to see what they do in the sequel. But now let's turn our attention to the audio in the game. Starting with the voice cast, there are a bunch of notable voice actors in the game, all of which are extremely talented, but I've gone ahead and picked out a few in particular to discuss, mostly to show you other roles you might know them from. We'll begin with the voice of Peter Parker, Yuri Lowenthal. Brian Inahar was initially reluctant to cast Yuri in the role because Yuri had been the male lead in their prior game, Sunset Overdrive. Brian didn't want it to feel like they were just reusing the same actors for new projects, but through the casting process, it was clear that Yuri matched what they were looking for with their Peter Parker. Interestingly, this wasn't Yuri's first time playing the role of Spider-Man in a game. His first time was in 2008 for a Zen pinball game. He's since gone on to reprise the role in other games such as Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3, and more recently, Marvel's Midnight Suns. However, there are some other roles you might recognize him from too. For example, his first big role was as the Prince in the Prince of Persia Sands of Time. He's also voiced Ben in the Ben 10 series. For all my horror people out there, I was also surprised to see that he voiced Joseph Oda in the first Evil Within game. And if you're looking for where you can find him next, outside of Spider-Man 2, he's also voicing the character Smoke in Mortal Kombat 1. Continuing on, let's talk about another Yuri, the voice actor portraying Captain Yuri Watanabe, Tara Platt. Believe it or not, Yuri Lowenthal and Tara Platt are actually married in real life, which I think makes the casting even more fun. Also, I can only imagine how confusing things were for a while with the two Yuri names and knowing who's being referred to at a given time. Tara does a great job as Captain Yuri Watanabe though, and I thought she excellently brought that character to life, to the point I'm really excited to see her return as Wraith in the sequel. Outside of Spider-Man, Tara has also voiced Tamari from the Naruto TV series, and you may also recognize her as Tron Bond from Marvel vs. Capcom 3. Next, I want to look at William Salyers, the voice of Dr. Octopus. We talked about it at length in the Part 1 video, and I felt William delivered a very strong performance as Otto, and I was impressed at how he played both sides of him so well, the gentle scientist and father figure for Peter, and the vengeful maniac hell-bent on revenge. Outside of this game, I was surprised to see that William had also voiced the character Rigby from the popular animated series Regular Show. Since Spider-Man PS4, William has reprised his role as Dr. Octopus in Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3, and more recently, he's voiced Bruce Banner in Marvel's Midnight Suns. Next up is an actress that I'm sure you've heard of, and that's Laura Bailey, voicing Mary Jane Watson. MJ gets a lot of criticism in this game, but Laura's performance isn't one of them. As always, Laura does an incredible job in the role, and she's an actress that you've likely seen elsewhere in a variety of other games. Just to name a few, she's voiced Abby in The Last of Us 2, Black Widow in Marvel's Avengers, Nadine Ross in Uncharted The Lost Legacy, and Magic in Marvel's Midnight Suns. That's really just scratching the surface, and I'm sure if you looked at her resume, you'd find plenty of other roles that you recognize her from. Also, fun fact, she's married to voice actor Travis Willingham, who voices Wilson Fisk in this game. Let's also take a look at Mark Ralston, who plays Norman Osborn. A lot of his background is in live-action roles, but he's been taking on more voice acting roles recently, and you'll likely recognize him from the Batman Arkham series, where he voiced Deathstroke in both Batman Arkham Knight and Batman Arkham Origins. Next up is Najee Jeter, who plays Miles Morales. Najee is newer to the acting scene, but he's had a notable gaming role in the past. Prior to playing Miles, Najee played Sam in the first Last of Us game. He's since gone on to reprise the role of Miles Morales in Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3, as well as his spin-off game, Marvel's Miles Morales, which I'm planning to cover in the future as well. I also want to bring up Electro's voice actor, Josh Keaton. If you're unfamiliar with that name, Josh has voiced Spider-Man in the past on a couple different occasions. For example, in the short-lived Spectacular Spider-Man animated series. He then went on to voice Spider-Man in the Shattered Dimensions game and its sequel, Edge of Time, both of which I'd highly recommend checking out if you haven't before. More recently, Josh has also been voicing Tony Stark in games. For example, Iron Man VR, a game I would absolutely recommend playing if you have a MetaQuest 2 headset. He also plays Tony in Marvel Midnight Suns, and it was one of my favorite performances in that game, so he's another talented actor that I hope to see more of. Lastly, I also want to call out Erica Lindbeck, the voice of Black Cat. Black Cat ended up being one of the standout characters for me in this game, and I think Erica did a good job of bringing her to life. Erica doesn't seem to be a stranger to Marvel properties either, and has actually played Captain Marvel on a couple occasions. For example, in Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3, and in Marvel's Midnight Suns. I was actually surprised at how much I liked Captain Marvel in Midnight Suns, so I think Erica has a knack for elevating characters beyond expectation, since she's done it to me twice now with both Black Cat and Captain Marvel. So she's another actress that I'm very interested in seeing more from. But now, let's turn our attention to the score of the game, composed by John Paisano. What initially caught my attention was that John has composed the score of other Marvel properties, the Netflix Defenders and Daredevil TV series, which if you've seen Daredevil in particular, you'll likely recall that tremendous opening theme music. I really like the Defenders theme as well, but I think Daredevil is the most memorable of the two. During an interview with PlayStationLifestyle.net, John was asked how he approached composing Spider-Man and Daredevil, and this was his response. For me, it's always important with these superhero properties, especially with Daredevil and the Defenders, and even with some of the Spider-Man stuff, I'm always trying to ground the character a little bit because it's almost like Spider-Man, for instance, you know he's got a suit, he's swinging around the city, there's very obvious superhero traits to them. So when you just throw a bunch of big superhero music on top of him, sometimes it's hard to kind of connect them to the real world. I always try to balance out some of the things a little bit. I always use the word ground to try to ground the character a little bit. It was the same thing with Daredevil, you know, we really kind of scored it like a drama versus a giant superhero. And then of course, at a certain point, you have to kind of submit a little bit and go into that superhero world. But it's always just trying to find that balance between large superhero music, but then also trying to connect into the world that we all live in. I like that he took this more grounded approach, and I think this benefits the game. The score felt like it matched the world and didn't ever feel too grandiose. I also think this more grounded approach helped punctuate when the score did go big, and I was always excited when it would elevate and take the spotlight for a moment. John also stated that he wanted to make the theme more personal to Peter, and I thought this quote was interesting, where he talks about scoring an older Peter. He has grown up a little bit. He's not by any means old or anything, but at the same time too, you change a lot from when you're 16 to when you're in your early 20s. We kind of wanted to make that reflective. Not only did Brian in the story, but I wanted to do it too with the music and the feel and how he views the world. So in the music, I tried to keep some of the old classic elements of that Marvel universe, but at the same time too, I took the approach where I scored more Peter Parker than I scored Spider-Man. There's also a great video on PlayStation's YouTube channel where John describes creating the Peter Parker theme and then using it to create the Spider-Man theme.
My name is John Paisano. I'm the composer for Marvel Spider-Man. In our game, Spider-Man's aged up a little bit. He's not in high school anymore. He's an older, more mature Peter Parker. We wanted to make the Peter Parker theme more emotional and introspective.
It's time to get up.
And it was a great theme, but it didn't have that propulsive energy that you might need when he got to be Spider-Man. And then through orchestration and instrumentation and arrangement, we took that Peter Parker theme and we turned it into a Spider-Man theme. It was kind of like putting on a superhero suit on the theme.
I also thought it was cool how the game's score adjusts based on what you're doing in the city. Whether that's swinging around the city or jumping into a fight, the score will adjust depending on what you're doing from moment to moment.
The trick always in these games, and we thought about this from the very beginning, how do we make the gameplay music as effective as a cinematic music? In movies, you have one piece of music, it's linear, it's static, it always plays the same way. You can play Spider-Man a bunch of different ways and the music's always gonna be changing and conforming depending on the player and what they're doing. So in a weird way, the player is controlling the way that score is operating.
Insomniac did a good job with this because I never really noticed the transitions and the moment-to-moment music always felt like it naturally followed my gameplay without noticeable changes. So I think that's really cool. They actually did a similar thing with Yuri Lowenthal's voice performance in the city. He had to record two variations of voiceover from the open world to match whether the player was swinging or walking. So we had one version where it sounds like he's exerting himself, and another version where he speaks more naturally. Here's an example of the two different versions.
Hey MJ, you're up late.
Just catching up on the news. Looks like you had quite an adventure with Shocker tonight.
Yeah, he was unusually combative. Anyway, thanks again for dinner. What do I owe you?
How about a favor? You still have that mask from the gallery?
Yeah. I'm actually on my way to the Feast Center now to ask Martin Lee about it.
Martin Lee? Why?
He has a degree in art history. If anyone knows about the origins of that mask, he will.
Just keep me in the loop. Like I said, I think there's a bigger story here, and I plan to be the one to break it.
Sure. So I can call you, like, whenever?
Yeah. Whenever, whatever.
Hey, MJ. You're up late?
Just catching up on the news. Looks like you had quite an adventure with Shocker tonight.
Yeah, he was unusually combative. Anyway, thanks again for dinner. What do I owe you?
How about a favor? You still have that mask from the gallery?
Yeah. I'm actually on my way to the Feast Center now to ask Martin Lee about it.
Martin Lee? Why?
He has a degree in art history. If anyone knows about the origins of that mask, he will.
Just keep me in the loop. Like I said, I think there's a bigger story here, and I plan to be the one to break it.
Sure. So I can call you, like, whenever?
Yeah. Whenever, whatever.
So the overall audio design between the score and the voice cast is really impressive. It's incredible that so much can naturally transition depending on what you're doing in the city, but just in general, I thought the score and voice acting were top-notch. I never had any complaints with either, and never had a situation where a performance or score took me out of the moment. So I think everyone involved with the game's audio design did a tremendous job. To wrap up my thoughts, Marvel Spider-Man is truly an impressive feat. I think everyone involved with the game deserves a ton of respect, and not only because it's such a good game, but because of how much hard work, teamwork, and skill went into making it that way. Throughout these last two videos, I tried to highlight moments where Insomniac, Sony, and Marvel cooperated to enhance the game where needed, even if it meant more work, more time, and/or more money. We've discussed plenty of games on this channel, and I'm sure we'll discuss plenty more, where the games were rushed to meet a deadline and weren't granted extra time or funding to make changes and flesh out the game. The result is that the game suffers, the workers are stressed, and the players are disappointed. So I'm happy to see that Insomniac, Marvel, and Sony all had a collaborative and healthy working relationship, and the quality speaks for itself. So I think it's so deserving that this is Sony's fastest-selling PlayStation game and continues to be one of their best-performing titles. Sony actually ended up buying Insomniac after this game released, which I think is pretty cool as well. Regardless, I see this game as highly innovative, especially with its approach to the traversal, which in my opinion is its standout feature. But it also features incredible combat mechanics and a high-quality story with many in-depth character arcs. It's really so impressive what they were able to do here, especially given the stress they must have been under initially. Spider-Man is a big name, and with it comes a lot of pressure to do it justice. Not only that, but this was Brian Inhart's first time as creative director. This was also a new beginning for Marvel Games, referring to it as their Iron Man, the same way the first Iron Man film kicked off the MCU in a major way. So I think this was a very ambitious game from the beginning, and I think it's so cool that everyone not only achieved their goals, but far and away exceeded them. I think this is Marvel Gaming's equivalent to Iron Man, and I'm really excited to see where Insomniac take things moving forward. Not only just the Miles Morales game in Spider-Man 2, but also the Wolverine game that they're working on. So I think there's a lot to look forward to in the Insomniac Marvel world, and after seeing their quality approach in this first game, I can't wait to see more. But I think that wraps up my thoughts on Marvel's Spider-Man 1. From here, we'll continue forward with more Spider-Man this year, but not immediately with Miles Morales. Honestly, having done the Batman Arkham series and now Spider-Man PS4 with Marvel's Guardians of the Galaxy still on the way, I'm pretty winded, so I think we'll go back further in time to some older, less involved games. So next up, I want to switch gears a bit and discuss a cancelled game, Daredevil for PS2, since a playable prototype recently became available. I've been dying to play a Daredevil game for years, so I was anxious to give this prototype a spin, so we'll take a look at it together coming up. After that, we'll continue our symbiote game series with the much-requested Spider-Man 3 movie game. So that's what I'll be working on next. In the meantime, if you're still in a Spider-Man mood, I have a bunch of other Spider-Man retrospective videos to check out, and I think the Spider-Man PS1 video is especially fun in relation to Spider-Man PS4, since it shows a fun evolution of where things started and where they are now. The Spider-Man 2 movie game is a lot of fun to look at as well, especially due to its innovative web swinging. But I think that's all for this video, so thank you again for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.